62, baby. That was the year that
you
was.
You look good, man. You look really good. You look really
good. It's because I work out all the time.
Is that what it is? No.
No.
Maybe because you don't.
Right. Shit.
Yeah.
We're on? Oh, Jesus Christ. I should probably have my headphones on. Although I am talking, this is not my podcast. This podcast belongs to the one and only Mr. Chris Ryan, ladies and gentlemen.
Yay!
Thank you.
Let everybody know what we're doing.
This is number three of our continuing series of Three Musketeer podcasts with Joe Rogan, Duncan Trussell, and yours truly. So now we're in Joe's studio, actually, because I don't have a studio.
Well, we were trying to figure out if we should do our own podcast, and we said, no, we already have three podcasts. Let's just swap off.
Yeah.
And I like that. It's really, we should name them, though, just so that people could find them, because I think
right.
a lot of these conversations are going to deal with some subjects that maybe they would want to reference, and they would forget which one it was, and we don't want them to have to listen to
right.
X amount of hours.
So we should come up with a title. I mean, Three Musketeers is too easy. Circle Jerk.
Tripod was one.
Tripod. The triangular.
I like the Three Amigos. Sounds
the
like.
The Three Amigos.
It sounds, good, yeah. I don't know. It sounds unpretentious.
How about the Lords of Truth?
Well, that's not pretentious.
I'm just kidding.
Yeah.
The spiritual arbiters of the Western world.
How about Shrimp Parade?
I just wanted to figure out a way to
shrimp
use arbiters.
Parade?
What is a shrimp parade?
I don't know. I have no idea. I'd go to one, though.
I thought that was some sort of reference to our penises, but that's just
that's because you always think about penises.
Well, you were just saying your podcast was a sausage fest, Duncan, and then
I wasn't using the term that didn't mean phallus.
Oh, you just talk
you're
about
the
sausage
sexist.
A lot.
No, I just mean like yeah, my podcast reminds me of a package of old, salty, briny, withered sausages. You might find at a secondhand meat store.
Briny.
Secondhand meat store. What the fuck is a secondhand meat store?
Discarded old sausage. Once this guy. No,
what a great description, though. Secondhand meat store.
Trader Joe's is. I got to get more girls.
Gals is what you said.
Sure, I said gals.
Gals.
He's trying to be funny, though. He's trying to be funny. That's the reason.
But is gal sexist?
No.
I mean, it shouldn't be.
It shouldn't be.
It should all be intent, right?
Okay, I was at this party the other day, and I met these two women who are on a TV show in England, right? And I said, oh, so you're actresses. And they said, no, we're actors.
Oh.
And I was like, okay. All right. So... And then my aunt was there, and my aunt was like, oh, I guess you should call me your uncle then. I mean, what, you know, what? What the fuck?
Yeah, it's so weird.
I got to go back to Spain.
Well, you know what it is? People, they're just looking for a reason to be upset. Like, you know as a human being what the intent behind that is. It does, there's nothing.
But, I mean, even logically, how can that possibly be sexist? Unless you believe being a woman is a bad thing.
Well, that's their assuming. You know? It's almost like they're assuming that you believe just because you make a distinction.
Yeah, like waitress? No, it's your server. Oh, fuck it. You know, I don't give a shit, man.
I ain't got time for that.
Yeah. Ain't got time. All right. Speaking of secondhand meat stores, do you guys have nicknames for your penises?
No.
Have we talked about this before?
No.
Because I'm thinking Deadwood would be a great nickname
Deadwood?
For your penis.
Deadwood? Happy birthday.
That's sad. That's sad.
That's terrible.
All right. So since I'm piloting this thing or driving this bus full of rambunctious children, this is brought to you by Squarespace, who I think sponsors all of us,
yes.
don't they?
I met them. I met them last weekend in New York.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
You're at the
fucking
Squarespace
amazing,
headquarters?
Amazing guys. They came to my show. I had a show with the Manhattan Center, and
oh,
the Squarespace
nice.
Guys all came. They're exactly what you would hope they would be.
Oh,
yeah,
cool.
They're cool.
Really cool, smart cats who are really friendly. Got a great website.
It's a fucking great website. My personal page, Chris Ryan PhD, is on Squarespace. I heard about them when I was on your podcast.
Yeah.
You have changed my life, man. I got a goddamn Samsung phone because of you. It's on Ting because of you. I'm on Squarespace because of you. I got a podcast because of Duncan.
And you hooked me up with Squarespace.
That's beautiful.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, cool. So anyway, Squarespace, they're just what you'd imagine.
They're awesome.
They're awesome. Yeah. It's a great, great thing. And we've talked about that a lot. And of course, our other
sponsor.
That's
your advertisement?
I'm not real good at
that. You didn't even give the website.
You have to give a website.
Squarespace.com. Say the code word, you get 10% off.
That's right. I always forget that part. The code word would be The code word is tangent 2 if you do it in February.
Terrible code word.
Yeah, it's a terrible code word.
Because no one can say tangent.
They're going to forget.
Tangent 2. Tan-
well, the, my podcast is Tangentially Speaking.
I know. Right? I totally understand.
Yeah. But so T-A-N-G-E-N-T. It should be like Chris.
Just well, Chris.
They gave it to me. What can I do?
This is what I always say. I know a woman who sells her stinky socks online and makes money doing that. That we live in a country where a website can you can use a website to generate dough from your discarded underwear and socks. Because nobody's doing any kind of DNA test to make sure that sock came from a lady, guys. You know what I'm saying? Squarespace. Underwear.
Don't you think they have a different smell, though?
Guys, you're wearing women's underwear anyway. Why not make some money from
it? Yes, yes, exactly. So you could build a website and sell stinky socks and probably make at least like $1,000 a month.
Yeah, if you hit the right, you got to hit the right river of stinky sock fans.
Yeah.
The ones with cash.
Yeah.
You know? Because, it, and then they also have to get on your radar. Like, you have to be like a stinky sock person that they would really like to acquire. I bet they acquire them from a bunch of different models.
Yeah.
They have specific stinky socks and they have like Ziploc bags and.
You guys know about the vending machines in Japan that sell.
Yes.
Girls' underwear. Yeah. 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 I mean.
Is that real? I tried to find those when I was there. I mean, just for research.
Of course.
But I didn't find anything.
They used to have them in the metro stations, I believe, but now they've taken them out.
That's so great.
But yeah, I think they are real. Japan is. I've never been there, but if this TV show that's got, people keep talking about ever comes about, I can't wait to go to Japan and do a whole thing.
Love it. It's fascinating.
I got to say, though, I don't approve ethically of those stinky underwear factories. Have you seen the way those things work in Japan? It's awful.
Are you serious?
Slave labor.
Yeah, there's just this one filthy woman who just has to keep putting underwear on and off.
Son of a bitch. He got me for a couple of seconds. Usually he doesn't get me. He starts going off and I'm like...
Oh, man, I saw that one coming a mile away.
You're better than me. You're better than me. As soon as he said there's one woman, I'm like, oh, you fuck.
It's a sweatshop. Give sweatshop a whole new meaning.
One woman sweatshop.
Your pussy doesn't smell bad enough.
I don't want to work here anymore.
All right, tangent 2, ladies and gentlemen. Set up your disgusting underwear site. They've got a template for it at Squarespace, I'm sure. I'm sure they do.
If they don't, they should.
They will soon.
You can make money, ladies. Come on.
Yeah.
Or guys.
Why so proud?
And, of course, our favorite sponsor, our sponsor that I also sometimes forget to mention, much to my chagrin and shame, is... Sure Design T-shirts. Go to SureDesignT-shirts.com. Duncan, do you have anything to say about Sure Design T-shirts?
These shirts are very, very, very soft. Really soft. These shirts are softer than the underscruff of Snowden's balls out there in Russia, his lotioned Patriot balls. They say, no, they say they're very soft. They say that, underneath his balls are, that was one of the things that his girlfriend said, his father said. It was like the special thing about him.
The NSA said it.
Incredibly, incredibly soft. And Bennett at Shirt Design T-shirts, he has modeled his shirts off of those sweet soft balls. So you're going to feel like you're wearing the balls of Snowden when you put on one of these shirts.
Of a patriot.
Wow.
That's fantastic.
That's intense stuff, boys.
Yeah. SureDesignT-shirts.com. And I've also got a discount code for them, too, but I can't remember what the fuck it is.
Ah!
So if you order something, use Duncan's. What's your discount code? Because they get 10% off, right?
Duncan.
Duncan or Chris or Joe or whatever. You'll get 10% off.
Just put tangent, too. Try that.
Tangent 718. Black Arrow 6.
Give it a shot because like,
it works
everywhere. You get credit for those. Like, people know that your podcast is working.
I know.
Especially, you have to really, I know you don't want to, but you have to consider this now that your podcast is getting so many downloads. I mean, your downloads are through the roof now.
They are. They've gone up just in the last month. I was hanging out with Duncan and we were talking about numbers and Duncan was like, oh no, don't look at the per episode thing. How many per month?
Yeah.
And I looked at it and it was like 120,000. That was like 2 months ago. And I just looked at it a few days ago and now it's like 240.
Wow.
It's just taken off probably because of these round robin things we're doing.
Well, like I said, our one podcast, one of the most popular downloads we've ever had was Kevin Smith, which was like 800,000, I think. 800,000 downloads. Yeah, he was great. But That was 2 years ago. This podcast has over 700,000 downloads, and it's only 2 weeks old.
Wow.
Like, the last one we did was three weeks, maybe?
Four.
4 weeks? Was it four?
Yeah.
Weeks?
It's funny, because I would think that there would be a lot of overlap in our audience.
I would think so, too, but I think we also have individual, unique components that are converging for this one.
Yeah. Yes.
So what do you think about the idea, like, if we're going to keep doing this, of occasionally having a fourth person in?
Why not?
Like, sure, in the lion den, you know?
Sure. Why not?
Yeah. If we get bored with each other, you know?
I don't think we should have any rules.
I'll tell you who needs to be interviewed by us. That actress who plays Khaleesi on Game of Thrones.
Oh, yeah.
I don't think you're going to handle it. I can't be near her.
All right. Well, you would be restrained. You'd have to be strapped into your chair.
We could strap you into your chair.
The way she so willingly gave herself to that barbarian dude.
Seth MacFarlane?
No. The guy who played Conan. What's his name?
Fabio.
MoMA or something like that. The perfect human.
Oh, the dude.
The perfect man.
The guy, the horse guy.
The main guy. The guy in the beginning.
Oh, yeah.
Remember the guy
with
the crazy
hair? His name was MoMA?
MoMA, I think it is. Jason MoMA?
Oh, MoMA. I thought you meant the character. His name was MoMA.
No, I forget his name, but he was the most badass barbarian ever.
Yes.
And they fucked with passion. And she was like, you know, she originally was like given to him or something like that. I forget the story. It was season one. But, you know, she sort of grew to love him.
Yeah.
And they just... This the way she fucked that barbarian, you're like, I can't be near that girl. It's too much going on.
That's
there.
A good thing in a woman.
Yes, you know, it is. It's too good.
Enthusiastic barbarian fucking.
Yeah. Her girl just gives in to her nature. Just finds that place inside of her. That crazy fuck beast
and
now, place.
The women who are listening to this are saying, yeah, but where are the barbarians? Where are they?
It's true. Yeah. Well, the guy, you know, any guy who complains about women being frigid or women being this, women being that, I always say, if you were a girl, would you fuck you?
Right.
Just stop and think about that. Yeah. Like, everyone complaining that your wife doesn't want to have sex. What do you do in your body? Like, take a look at yourself. Like, you have to not just think about how you're attracted to her. You have to think about, would she want to be attracted to you? Like,
and not just your body, as it's the day
personality,
the day before Valentine's
passion.
Day.
You gotta have passion.
Is this podcast being sponsored by any like Hallmark or like chocolate strawberry companies or anything like
yes,
that?
Yes, I mean, where's the romance? Curtis's Chocolate Strawberries in Los Angeles,
and the secondhand meat store.
1-800 Flowers is one of my new ones.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Well, there
people,
you go.
People love that shit. I love flowers, man.
I've been reading this book by Henry Miller called Tropic of Cancer.
Great book. Oh,
if you want to read about passion or about fucking, like, I don't know what Henry Miller looked like,
easy.
But if I could fuck like Henry Miller, because like when you read his descriptions, I memorize it because it's so amazing. I will shoot hot bolts into you. I will make your ovaries incandescent.
Whoa.
And you can actually read about Henry Miller fucking from the woman's perspective if you want.
Oh, really?
Because he was fucking a nice nin, and she wrote about it.
What did she say?
Well, I didn't memorize her stuff. You know, it's wordy. But check it, a nice nin. I mean, they had this famous three-way. There was a film about it, Henry, and I don't remember. Because she was married to a banker. And he was cool with her fucking Henry Miller, who was penniless in Paris.
I think he was writing about her in that line because he kept talking about her husband.
Right.
You know, he kept talking about her husband saying like, he basically said, you know, when you go back to him, you will be able to fit baboons into your pussy. I swear to God, I haven't memorized the line, but it's like that good. And it's so passionate. It's so passionate. It's not like, you know what I mean? It's not like he's like that consumed with lust for this woman, and you can just feel it coming out of the book. And if you're not living like that, if you're not having sex like that, then yeah, it sucks. You're not a barbarian or whatever. You're just I'm talking to myself here. Like, when I watch myself kind of like all in my head having sex, and you realize like, I am totally in my fucking head right now. My snow globe is just so shaken up, and I'm only enjoying maybe like 6 seconds out of every minute of this sex because I keep spinning off into my head. I'm getting better. Meditation.
So wait a minute. When you're in the middle of sex, you spin off and start thinking about other shit?
Not all the time, but sometimes if you're not care, I mean,
Wow.
Yeah, sure. Of course.
That's the one time I never have a problem. I never have that.
Oh, my
God. That's the one time. I mean, I could be doing anything, and I could get inside my head accidentally and go on a journey and start spinning
all
these different
things. But not fighting, right?
No. Well, you can't.
Yeah, that's...
You can't.
I mean, that's the
thing.
Not
even training. I haven't fought in a long time, but even training. Even training. You can't even do it in training.
I'm the same. For me, sex is the one thing that completely focuses my mind. And rock climbing, which I did once.
Whoa.
And it's the last time I whimpered.
I would imagine that would fucking put a pucker in your little butthole.
Yeah, yeah. I think,
what puts a pucker in your butthole?
I mean, rock climbing.
Sex. Oh.
That too. Rock climbing, man.
Yeah, no, rock climbing is intense. I mean, anything scuba diving, you know, anything where your body's convinced you're about to die really focuses your mind.
All right, well, I don't feel like I'm going to die when I'm having sex. I'm just
doing it wrong.
Well, but sex for me, I mean, really? Especially when I was younger, I used to try to think about other things just to stop from coming.
Yeah.
And you know what worked for me? Old people in snow. That was the only thing that worked.
That's
a good one.
Somebody hit that. Old people in yellow snow.com.
Old people trudging through the snow.
Maybe that should be our podcast. Old people in snow.
Yes!
That's not a bad idea.
Sounds like we're doing blow or something. Old people on snow.
On snow.
It's the only thing that kept Chris Ryan from coming as a child.
From like 14 to 27. Yeah. Yeah. Those were the years. Oh, one other thing I do sometimes in the podcast, I like shout out to people who sent me emails, interesting emails.
That's a terrible idea. You should cease that at once.
Well, all right. I'll cease it right after I do this one. Jack William Verburn, or however he says it, he lives in New Zealand, had a shitty job. He wrote to say, I emailed you last year asking for advice, da-da-da. You didn't feel comfortable, but you said something, and you said to me, the only way to fly is to jump. So I thought I'd email you again and tell you that because of listening to you and Duncan and Joe...
I'm now paralyzed.
I found out about airplanes. You're full of shit, man. The only way to fly is get on a fucking airplane.
So I quit the job I hated. I sold my car, and I'm leaving New Zealand, going to Southeast Asia to travel for 6 months. I thought you'd like to know you guys helped me, and I'll be listening to your podcast on the planes, trains, and buses in Asia.
Do you get a lot of those?
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Because, you know, like my thing, you know, is like I traveled a lot. So I get a lot of emails from people saying, I don't know what to do, man. I'm with this woman. I don't know if I love her. I got this job. I kind of hate it. And I was thinking maybe I should go travel. I don't know. What do you think? And I'm like, dude, you're writing to me. You know, your answer is in the fact that you chose me to write to. You know,
it's real hard to give someone advice if you don't know them.
Yeah,
give someone advice through an email. I see what they're doing. They're just trying to reach out to you. But what I get a lot is the podcast changed my life story.
Yeah,
I get that fucking thing. I decided to take a chance. I decided to live with passion. I decided to abandon my job, lose my burdensome relationship, get my shit together, stop eating sugar. I've heard all those things, you know, and all the time, like constantly, and completely unintended side effect of something that I thought was just going to be fun.
Yeah.
I just thought it would be fun to have, you know, I have a bunch of funny friends. And that's how we started doing these in the green rooms of comedy clubs. Remember we did one at Cobb's. We're on Justin TV. We've done them a bunch of times. We just set up a webcam and start talking. And to the idea that would somehow or another change, who knows how many people's lives. I mean, I've lost track. How many people came up to me and told me they lost 100 pounds? How many people came up to me and told me they started exercising and they got off antidepressants, they feel better than they've ever felt in their life. Their whole life is super positive now. They realize that you can get a pattern going where you're just constantly nice to people and then it can really enrich and change your life. I get those emails every day. I get those emails all day. It's bizarre.
It's fantastic.
But it's weird because it's totally unintended and unforeseen. I never saw it coming.
Right. Well, it's a tuning fork, man.
That's it. It's a resonance, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, the theme that keeps coming through in mind is like, you know, people just feel like they have connected with a community.
Yes.
Right? And it's not, they haven't found it in the town they live in, whatever. And I think we've talked about this before. It's not that we're doing anything that's so unusual. It's just that it resonates with people around the world, and that's wonderful, man.
Well, we got lucky and we found each other. And we got lucky and we found each other physically. And we can all hang out together physically. We can go to dinner and joke around. But if you're stuck in Hammond, Indiana, and, you know, you're in a small town, and maybe your neighbor's a douchebag. Maybe the kids you go to school with are assholes. Maybe everyone's stupid. Maybe they throw rocks at gay people. Who knows what the fuck the issue is, but you're stuck in that geographic spot.
Right.
But because of this, they're interacting with people that aren't stuck. And that maybe we were, and I know several of us were. Several, there's only three of us. We've all been in bad
Duncan
spots.
Duncan's stuck when he's fucking. Right?
He's stuck in his head.
Fuck stuck.
You guys can kiss my ass.
Would that focus your mind?
It's not all the time. Oh,
what part of your ass specifically?
You two legendary lions of lovemaking, focused as though you're climbing a rock. Please, I'm thinking about my mom dying.
I'm
taxes.
Focused.
What?
Taxes? You don't pay taxes, do you?
I'm just kidding. No, I'm joking.
Yeah. So, Joe, when you're player, either of you guys, when you guys are playing in a town that is like a conservative town, I know Bill Maher sometimes says he loves playing in like shithole conservative towns because the people come out like that's their one chance to not be in the minority.
That makes sense.
Do you get that?
I heard Salt Lake City's like that. I still haven't done Salt Lake City, but I need to. I keep hearing that about that Wise Guys Club. I keep hearing that's fucking fantastic.
Oh, really?
Diaz just came back. He was there, I think, a couple months ago. He said it was amazing.
All right. Duncan, are you on the road again? Or what are you doing?
He's coming with me.
I'm going with Joe.
Good.
And then I'm working on, finally, I've started going up regularly again, and it's great. So, yeah, I was going to do a podcast tour, but now I'm thinking I'll just, like, keep building this new set that I'm working on and just go on the road.
Just have some fun, man. Just get back on the horse. You're too good to not be doing comedy.
And I just had to take a break, but I'm definitely doing it again, and it feels good. I mean, it was, awesome. You know, you just like, you just have to, I mean, I've never been one of these industrialist artists who's just like, I'm going to go up no matter what, never a sick day, always go up. I can't do it like that. It has to feel, I need to like be drawn to it so that I feel excited about it. Because otherwise you're up there and you just feel like you're some kind of automaton sort of rolling through some nonsense. For what reason?
Right.
It's not fair for the audience. Even if they're laughing, it's still like, it's no good. I think it's better to like do things when you're inspired. Not that you're always going to be inspired, but you need to like just trust that if there's a pause in your desire to do some art form, don't apply fucking the same way you build a car to the way you like try to communicate deep parts of yourself to the world.
Especially considering that you went through a very emotional and a really powerful, profound experience, the loss of one of the most important people in your life, your mother.
Yeah,
that's something that you don't get over very quickly. I mean, Phil Hartman was a very good friend of mine, but he wasn't as close to me as your mother was to you. And when Phil died, I was fucked up for a long time. And I did go on stage too soon. And I had two really bad sets because of it, but one unbelievably bad. I ran into a friend who was a cop. On the way to the Comedy Store, I was at the gas station and I was pumping gas, and my friend Steve was there. I go, hey, what's going on? Blah, blah, blah. We start talking. And it had been the first time I was about to go on stage after Phil died. And he was telling me that his friends in the force were there. I don't know if you know the story, but Phil Hartman killed his wife and then she killed herself.
His wife killed him.
Thank you. Phil Hartman's wife killed him and then she killed herself. And she killed herself while the cops were outside. They found out that she had done this. She called them or something happened. Somehow or another, it became aware that she had killed her husband. And the cops showed up, and she had the children in the bathroom, and she had a gun out. And she was going to kill the children and so that they could all be in heaven with, you know, with daddy. I mean, it's one of those things that when a mother knows she's going to kill herself, oftentimes they'll kill their children. It's really dark shit. And they smashed the door down, and the kids ran away from their mother. And when the kids ran away from their mother, boom, she blew her brains out. So she blew her brains out with the cops outside. So I'm hearing all this while I'm pumping gas, about to go tell ha-has and hee-hees, you know, and I just ate shit. I couldn't be funny if my life depended on it. I was unbelievably bummed out getting onto the stage. Every thing that came out of my mouth felt pointless. It was It was a terrible experience, and it was only like 2 weeks after he died. So I really had no business being on stage. I think what you did was really smart. You took a long time and you let your emotions settle. And loss is a big thing, man. It's not to be taken lightly. And there's no shame in wanting to rekindle your desire to do something that you love doing. I mean,
yeah,
right.
Do what you do.
I mean, the way you went through the experience, and still are going through experience with your eyes open, you know, interviewing your mother and like being completely conscious as that was happening. Dude, I have so much respect for you for doing that. I mean, I'll be honest with you. I still haven't listened to those podcasts because I'm afraid of how much pain I'll go through. I'm a pussy, you know, and you were there, and that's your life. I mean, it blows my mind.
Yeah, it's, you know, though, there's this, it is intense, but it is totally normal. I mean, that's the other thing you have to realize is that your mom dying.
Right. It's going to happen.
Definitely going to happen. Like, there's no way around it. It's definitely going to happen. And then once you start realizing that, and I appreciate what you guys are saying, and I'm not trying to underplay. It sucked. I had grief, and grief isn't like getting a psychic flu. It's like the worst heartbreak of your life, you know, times 10. It's you go crazy in some weird way. But what's really interesting is when you start realizing that this is not abnormal. This is normal. And then you realize, like, oh, my God, all of society is built on not acknowledging this thing that will happen to every single person. They don't teach it in class. There's no class in high school where they teach you, well, here's what's going to happen. Your parents are going to die, and everyone you know is going to die, and everything you have is going to go away, and you're basically a renter existing in this dimension for only a certain amount of time. So definitely make sure that you return those calls. And et cetera. Don't take this for granted. It sounds a little cliche, I know, but it's the fact that those things aren't taught to us, but instead we kind of get this window through TV into this basically a very certain age range, 20 to 30 maybe, the young age range. Usually it's young, beautiful people on TV. You see this kind of window into like the height of virility in a person's life. That's most of what we like to look at. We like to look at young people. And so then this, when your parents die or when your friend dies or when whatever happens, it always blows your fucking mind.
It's always a surprise.
It's always a surprise, but it also is like, holy shit. Holy fucking shit. We're all right at the edge of a cliff.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Yeah. We've been walking along the edge of a cliff since we were born.
Well, it's also, it puts into perspective what life really is. Because when a person dies, they vanish.
Yeah.
And yes.
That is an incredibly strange thing.
Yeah.
They don't exist anymore. And it makes you really try to conceptualize what is being alive. Like, what is this exact experience? Am I just so accustomed to it? Is it so normal to me that it seems like something that makes sense? But then objectively, I think about death and you're disappearing. Like, what are you talking about? It stops existing and then it goes, what the fuck is going on there? Like, it's not a rock, okay? It's not water. It's not metal. It's a person. And then it stops being alive. Why? What the fuck is that all about? Like, what's going on there?
Yes.
Like, why is it? Yeah. Why does it disappear?
Yes.
But we still exist on Facebook.
Yeah, but it stops. Like, why would that be built into the system? Why would it be built in the system that it stops?
Yeah, I mean,
planned obsolescence.
Personally,
Flappy Bird, man. Have you played Flappy Bird?
But does it stop?
It's a fun fucking game. You only get one life.
That's the question.
Yeah. Does it really stop? I mean, does a raindrop cease to exist when it lands on the ocean?
Are you the same person today as you were when you went to bed yesterday? I'm not exactly sure, man. Yeah. I don't understand what the fuck's going on when I go to sleep. I'm not pretending that I understand it. I know that I shut off and then I don't have any recollection or idea of anything for 8 hours. And it's normal. I think that's uber bizarre.
Yeah.
I just got an email from a friend who is writing a book about her husband's experience. He went in for surgery and something went wrong. He had some sort of brain trauma and he forgot everything about his life until that moment.
Oh, I've heard of that before.
Sonia Leah is her name. And so she's writing this book about it. And like the dude's a virgin. He's never had sex. Wow. He doesn't know her. He knows he's married to her, but only because that's what he's been told.
Oh, my God.
And so it's like going through all these things again with him, you know? Incredible.
That was just really, there was something on today that was flittering around through Twitter.
Oh, maybe it's that. Maybe it's her thing. I met her in Seattle. She came to one of my readings up there.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's nuts. I have a friend, David McLean. I went to college with him, and he just put out a book called The Answer to the Riddle Is Me. And he was in India.
Oh,
did I tell you?
No, but I read about him in the New York Times. I read about his thing, and he was in a train station.
He's like one of my best friends in college.
And I heard your podcast. That's incredible. Yeah.
We went to India together. He went back to India on a Fulbright scholarship. He's taking this stuff called Larium, which is this like really weird anti-malaria drug that was manufactured in this strange partnership between the United States military and some pharmaceutical company. Essentially, yeah, it's like a weird baby that was born from these two entities. And what it does, like, the problem with it is like a certain percentage of people, what happens is it builds up in your brain in a way that it sort of clogs up your synapses and it can fuck you up.
Yeah.
When I was in India, I was taking Larium and I had this dream that I'll never forget this dream because it was so vivid and horrible. But this like pirate skeleton with a meat hook hand ripped my stomach open and I could feel it pulling my intestines out. And I was really rattled from this dream. And I went outside and I told this this traveler what happened. And the first thing he said is like, "Are you on Larium? Are you taking Larium?" And I'm like, "Yeah." He's like, "That's illegal in Europe. That stuff, they can't sell it in Europe because it's so dangerous." He's like, "Stop taking it. You'll go psychotic." Well, anyway, my friend, he's in a train station in India. And he suddenly doesn't know who he is. He doesn't know why he's there, where he is. He can't. He's like looking at the TV screen, trying to understand what the languages are rolling across the screen. He forgets his entire identity, ends up in a fucking mental asylum in India. In India, they think he's just overdosed on like recreational drugs or something like that. And he has full-on amnesia he doesn't understand any, like he's laying in a bed in some house where they're taking care of him and he doesn't understand why he's there or where, anything. It's all gone. It's all gone. But yeah, that idea of amnesia, I think it's a very special idea because that's what every single
baby
has.
What are the people treating him saying?
Well, he said that actually a religious person came into the room and started running some kind of Jesus game on him and stuff. And like, you know, right away they were trying to get him into Jesus. They were trying to use this blank little fresh fertile little field to plant those Jesus seeds in there. Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. What a bunch of creeps.
Yeah. Yeah. They tried to get him. Fuck. What's better than amnesia for a fundamentalist, man? An amnesic brain.
Yeah.
Woo. You could fill that thing up with so many lies and weird shit. You could tell someone they're God. You could like sit down and tell someone that you're like, just, you know, you're the Messiah.
Do you know the story about the assassin, the first assassins?
Yeah,
the Hashishim?
The Hashishins, yeah.
Yeah, similar kind of thing. There was some king in Persia, and he needed, he wanted soldiers who would do anything for him. So he sent guys out with hashish, got young boys, like 14-year-old boys, stoned out of their minds till they passed out. I guess they ate the stuff or whatever. And then they brought their bodies, there's passed out guys, into the palace grounds, right? So when they woke up, they were surrounded by beautiful women and fountains and plates of food and whatever you want, right? And the guys are like, "What the fuck is it? You're in heaven. You died. You're in heaven. This is heaven. Welcome to heaven." So they hang out for a while, fuck all these girls, have all the pleasure they can imagine. And then the king would come and say, "Okay, listen, we want to send you back to earth now, but you have to do something for us. You have to kill this guy. But don't worry, if something happens to you, if you get killed or whatever, you'll just come back here. No problem." Drug them again. They wake up in the street. With a mission.
That's some great
hash. Oh, that's crazy. Oh my God.
Talk about like playing a con. That's running brilliant. A con on some dudes there. Jeez.
That's brilliant.
You guys, I was watching Anderson Cooper the other night, AC 360, because I'm staying at someone's house and it was on the TV. And
you like to see smug gay people in the news?
I do. It turns me on. But anyway, he was talking about this guy who shot a bunch of kids in a car. You know, there's always the trial, de jour. Anyway, the guy's talking. They're showing the guy in church. I mean, in church, in court. And he says, "So what did the kid say to you?" And the kid said, "Oh, you know, it's time to kill this motherfucker." It's like, what, motherfucker, on CNN? Never heard that before.
Oh.
Pretty strange. So then they go to the next story is about that giraffe in Denmark. That, yes. Did you hear about that?
Yeah. Tell the story.
So they've got a giraffe in the zoo, and because of inbreeding, the giraffe, it's a young male giraffe, but they can't really use it for the breeding program. So, and there's nowhere to give, no one wants it in the other zoos and whatever. So they decide they're going to kill the giraffe, do an autopsy, cut it up and feed it to lions. And they're going to make it an educational thing. So there are all these kids there. So they, yes, like, invite schools to come and see it. And, of course, Anderson Cooper and his whoever it was, Hannah, Jack Hanna or some guy, were outraged by this. You know, the cruelty of killing this giraffe and, oh, my God, how can you do this in front of children?
With a bolt gun.
Yeah, the same way they kill pigs and everything else. And so they had the zoo director on, this Danish guy, and the guy was just like completely, from my point of view, was completely rational.
He's great. Like,
oh, you saw this?
Yeah.
Yeah, it was fantastic. He's like, you know, what's the problem? There is death.
Yeah.
You know, there is death. And this, you know, this is, we believe, what I thought was really cool is he said, you know, we believe that the animal's life should be as good as possible while it's alive. In other words, it's quality over quantity. Mm-hmm. And, of course, the Americans were saying, no, how could you do this? How could you do this? They were outraged. Why? Because it's cute?
It's so hypocritical. What the fuck? First of all, what do you think those animals are eating when they're in that zoo?
Exactly.
365 days a year. They're eating murdered animals, period. That's right. It. It's the only way to do it. You got to kill animals and feed them to lions. They don't eat cheese. They don't eat breadsticks.
No shit. Somebody should tell Anderson Cooper about the lions that eat giraffes every fucking day.
He's an idiot. Well, you know, there's a lot of idiots when it comes to the idea of animals. You know, you can't make that distinction that one animal, because it's in a zoo, is more important than another animal that has to die anyway. You're deciding that one animal's a better animal. A giraffe's better than a cow.
Right. It's hypocrisy around animals, and what reminded me of this was it's hypocrisy around death.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
it's bad for children to see that.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, he said that the children were asking questions.
Right.
And they were curious about it. It's natural, and it's people are really weird with that. The animal thing is a very strange thing, and this is coming from a person. I love animals. I really do, but I've cut animals up before. I've killed them and I've cut them up before, and I eat them. And that's what people have been doing since the beginning of time. And if you don't eat those animals, there's a whole bunch of problems associated with that. First of all, they're not going to live forever. And second of all, there's overpopulation. There's all sorts of issues that you'd have to deal with.
You won't know what they taste like.
You wouldn't know they're delicious and good for you. They're actually nutritious. Look, they shouldn't suffer.
True.
They definitely shouldn't suffer. But that giraffe got a bolt to the brain. I mean, that's instantaneous death.
Yeah. If I had to pick between a bolt to the brain or some giant thing ripping me to shreds while I was screaming.
Well, that's how they do it in a lot of countries still. They release animals out of cages in Siberia or in Asia. They have this cage in the back of a truck. They tip the cage over. A goat jumps out. And tigers rip it apart.
Yeah.
That's how they feed them.
It's just sad. The thing is, it's the reason this is particularly shocking is only because it has the components of a Disney movie, except the way that it ends is not the way it would end in a Disney movie. The way, you know what I mean? Somebody would, the giraffe would escape with an otter or something, and they'd go to New York and start a sushi shop or something.
Although, what was Bambi? And Bambi's pretty dark, right? And that's one of the most famous children's movies of all time.
Those are old movies. Those old movies got dark.
And Old Yeller. You guys ever read Old Yeller?
I saw it. I cried.
Oh, I cried my ass off that book. It's about a kid's dog who gets
fucked up by raccoons.
Yeah, he gets rabies. And the kid has to kill his dog in the end, right?
It's the point is we're not supposed to spend our time fixating on the fact that there's death in the universe and that we're all going to fall into the void and everything's going to go away, but it needs to be acknowledged.
Right.
And the more that you escape from that truth, the more likely you are to take the people around you for granted.
Exactly. And take your own life for granted.
Yes. Yeah. And that's why those stories are important for kids. That's why Watership Down is so important. And all those stories teach you to appreciate what's happening around you right now, if you can. Because if you haven't really like looked at where you're at, which is that you're going to get sick, people think like, oh, you're negative that you think like that. It's not like I'm always thinking about that. It's just that I know that the more that I've digested that truth, the more interesting my life becomes. I'm not saying happier, actually. I'm not saying that my life suddenly gets blissful.
Happiness is for idiots.
Yeah.
Let's face it.
Why do we always have to be fucking happy? What is that?
Yeah. I hate when people ask me if I'm happy.
I'm happy.
Well,
I must be an idiot.
You're not an idiot, Joe.
You're
but,
not an idiot, but you're, Joe. You're, it's a different form of happiness.
Yeah, it's a different thing, man. I'm talking about that kind of like numbed out, yeah. blank face, fucking like emoticon grin as you wander around like a little zombie, not even aware of really.
Well, constantly happy? Yeah.
Constantly happy. How's that? What is that? That's not good.
I'm not paying attention.
Honestly, Duncan, that's one of the things that keeps me away from the sort of retreats that you go to sometimes. Is there too many happy people there? They creep me out.
Oh, man.
Too many blissful smiles.
I know.
I need sarcasm.
No.
I need nasty, you know, snark.
That's the thing, man. You'd be surprised, man. A lot of the people I know who go to those retreats are fucking, they do snark, and it's hilarious, and it's like, there's no bullshit happening. Like, yeah. I've definitely been, like, beautifully insulted, but in a sweet way. Well, the way you do, like a friend, you know, yeah. like this, my friend Raghu Marcus, who runs the Love Serve Remember Foundation. I remember like, I remember like, that's Ram Dass's foundation. He definitely does not like, he definitely has called me out of my bullshit in a really sweet way that where right. it's inarguable. And just the way that he's doing it is like, oh, wow, that's fucking cool, man. I see what you're doing. And it doesn't make me feel defensive, but you're definitely pointing to parts of me that like I feel insecure about or uncomfortable about. So the wrong type of retreat, you definitely will end up with a bunch of like phony shitheads wandering around. But man, I think if you go to the right one, that might not be a good
thing. Every time someone like does this thing with their hands and says namaste, I just want to slap somebody, you know.
Satnam.
Namaste.
Namaste. By the way, you just gave me a great new nickname for my penis.
What?
Namaste. Love server member.
Ah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Get it tattooed on there.
Commit.
Commit, man. Yeah, I think that's one of the big problems is people confuse spirituality with being a pussy, because there's so many people who imitate being spiritual, and whenever you see that, that's when you run into that fucking, that's when you get the sense
yeah.
that you're having some weird thing run on you. But the when you run into people who are really working on themselves, usually what you get is just this they're authentic.
Right.
But that's what's important about what you're saying. People that are really working on themselves, meaning that it's a struggle, it's a quest, it's not. There's not really a destination where you get and all of a sudden you're enlightened. And these people that are pretending to be like constantly spiritual and Satnam, you know, Namaste.
Yeah.
What they're doing is like they're putting on a show, and by doing that, you're not doing all the work. You're not really being a person. I mean,
right.
not all of them, but the ones that are phony. You know, that feeling that you get from them is like
yeah.
you've just sort of adopted this predetermined pattern. You've sort of adopted it, and now you're claiming spiritual.
Off the rack hippies are yeah. so irritating.
Off the rack. That's the best way to describe.
Great
it.
Great way to put it, man.
Yeah, typically yeah. unique.
You know right away somebody hasn't really started the work when they start chastising you for getting angry. Like sometimes, like or some, I'll get emails from people like, mm-hmm. "Well, you seemed really negative in that podcast." It's like, yeah, no shit. What do you fucking think this does?
Yeah.
Do you think it's like a lobotomy? Do you think meditation or working on yourself eradicates this essential part of the human experience, which is from time to time being a fucking cunt? Because it doesn't.
Well, not only that, when you're ranting and raving about things, there you have to take into account that there's an entertainment aspect to it. It's fun to go on
right.
these crazy secondhand meat rampages.
Yes.
You know? When you're doing these things, I know what you're doing. You're not just saying your feelings. You're also making me laugh.
Yeah.
You're also
right.
saying things that are preposterous and creative and all intertwined. And
yeah.
It's funny. You go crazy. I know you're not really that mad. You're smiling when you're doing it.
Right. Yeah.
You know, you're fucking you're
it's
angry and smiling at the same time. And some people don't want to see that. They just want to say, oh God, it's been so negative lately. What the fuck is wrong with you? He's hilarious.
They want Krishnamurti. They want Krishnamurti. They want this calm. People want, if they think that, they don't get it. That's why so much. One thing Aubrey said on my podcast that I really liked, he was talking about doing ayahuasca and coming into contact in this realm, the shamanic realm, with people's higher beings, like the highest thing, the thing that's inside of you, that seed of perfection that's in all of us. If like suddenly you just dropped all the baggage, you forgave everybody you were ever angry at, you accepted the reality of your incarnation, what would you be like, you know? And he was saying like, it's not as though that person is going to be different than you or more pacified or like talk slower, it's going to be even more exuberant and more just a purer version of the happiest or the most in tune you've ever been. I love that idea. I think people get confused, and the reason they don't want to like read those fucking spiritual books or try meditating or any of that shit is because they think they're going to shuffle around like that guy from One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest.
Right, which is what the pharmaceutical quote-unquote wisdom will provide for you. People think antidepressants take away sadness. They don't know they take away sadness and happiness. They
also
reduce
take away
the
remorse, which is one of the issues that they think is correlating and connecting them to school shooters. There's
really?
A massive connection between people on or having withdrawals from SSRIs and antidepressants and these massive these situations, mass shootings.
Wow, I didn't know that.
Yeah, well, if you Google it, it's very disturbing because you never hear it brought up by politicians. There's so much money involved in the pharmaceutical industry that it, along like cigarettes, are these evil sacred cows. They're these things that you're not allowed to talk about. And I don't think all pharmaceutical drugs are evil, don't get me wrong. I think they've done mostly good, actually. I think they do a tremendous job in curing people of diseases and fixing people's issues and prolonging people's lives and improving the quality of their lives. But they also make a lot of money. And when you have that, people tend to make rationalizations that ensure that they continue to make a lot of money. And in doing so, a lot of times you shield the truth because you don't want to change. You want to keep extracting money from the system. But when you look into it, if you do the Google search on school shootings and SSRIs, it's terrifying. And what's that? The expression that causation does not equal correlation or
right.
whatever the fuck it is?
Yeah, the opposite.
Yeah, correlation does not equal causation. That's true. It could be that it just so happens that all these people were insane, which is why they were on antidepressants in the first place. That could be what happened. But my experience from talking to people that were on it, by the way, Phil Hartman's wife was on it when she shot him. She was doing that and cocaine. And they actually got a suit. They won money from Zoloft, I believe.
Mm.
It gets it so you don't give a fuck. That's what it does to you.
So it creates a psychopath.
Mm-hmm. Well, in a way, to the right person.
Yeah.
To some person, no. I mean, I've had friends that have taken antidepressants and it's changed their life for the positive. I've
more than one,
several, and it made them way happier and they're fun to be around and they're enjoying life and and there really was no fault of their own. They had a wire that was fucking crossed.
You look at scans of a depressed person's brain and a non-depressed person's brain and it's clear that there is something different going on in there. It's not like you're just like feeling sorry for yourself.
There's something going on different in all of our brains, man. I mean, we have different ingredients and different life experiences, different epigenetics. There's a lot of different shit going on in every person's brain. And I think that there's not one thing that's universally good for everybody. There's some people have massive allergies to dogs. And other people like me love dogs and have never had a problem. My wife can't touch dogs.
Mm.
She touches them, she gets these goosebumps and these dark rings, red spots all over her. And she has to wash it off, and it'll stay for like an hour. It's weird, but it's a direct allergy to dogs. We're all fucking different, man.
She's okay with barbarians, though.
She likes that shit.
Yeah.
she's okay with monkeys.
You know, another thing, I don't mean to be kissing your ass here, but we're supposed to kiss your ass, right?
Why?
You said it earlier. I've been reading The War of Art, which I heard about from you. It's fucking great.
Amazing.
It is a really good book. Amazing. And then there's a thing in there where he says he used to work for some advertising firm, and the boss said, you know, invent diseases, and then we'll be able to sell them the drugs, you know? And so they came up with all these bullshit diseases that now
are... What, pig demons?
Yeah.
Well,
yeah,
isn't this what they're saying now about ADHD, that there is no ADHD? That's just nonsense.
I'm tired of hearing myself talk about this book I haven't written yet, but in Civilized to Death, that's one of the things I'm going to talk about is how, you know, we pathologize normal human behavior when it doesn't fit into the civilizational structure, right?
Yeah.
So whether it's, you know, we call it promiscuity, we call women who like to fuck sluts, we call kids who don't like to sit in a room for 8 hours a day hyperactive. You know, it's insane. We call, you know, guys who can't get a job because we've painted them into a corner in which there are no jobs, drug dealers. Of course they're fucking drug dealers. What else are you going to do on the streets of Baltimore if you're a black kid? I mean, what the fuck, you know? I mean, it's so, yeah, that pattern plays out.
How about you take a kid who's really smart and you force him to go to an internment camp for teenagers called high school. Yeah. And then when he's there, you surround him with people who think he's a fucking asshole because he uses big words.
Right.
You get he gets the shit kicked out of him every fucking day, psychologically or physically, by people who are probably a lot dumber than he is. And then during this time, he's got to sit in an uncomfortable fucking desk and have information jammed into his brain by people who aren't getting paid enough and who are like having to do this terrible tap dance for the federal government because they've created a testing system that makes it so that you're no longer trying to get people to absorb information and understand it. You just want them to memorize it so you get a high score so you keep your fucking job. And during that time, you start thinking, you know what? Something seems fucking wrong here. I don't feel good in this situation. I'm starting to feel like life sucks. Maybe I want to kill myself. You tell the guidance counselor that, and the guidance counselor says, no, 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 no. You're just depressed. We're going to get some chemicals into your brain, and it's going to fix everything. Mm-hmm. So now you're medicated like somebody in a fucking lunatic asylum, and then during that time that you're medicated, your mind starts shattering because you begin to think, is this what life is? For the rest of my life, I'm going to have to be surrounded by people who are fucking monstrous, who are telling me that all I could hope to do is like work in a machine shop. Oh, I know. More jobs. There's more jobs because Obama's going to build more roads. That'll be a fun job for me, building the fucking roads, just like the slaves used to do in ancient Egypt. So you start going crazy. Your mind starts melting down. And the next thing you know, you're wandering through the halls of your fucking high school shooting people. Whose fault is it? Is it the pharmaceutical companies? Is it the teachers? Is it the parents? Is it the fucking kid himself? It's just a perfect storm.
Or is it a perfectly logical result of those conditions?
Yeah,
it is. You would almost be something wrong with you if you weren't depressed.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, you look at teen anger, you know, the angry young man phenomenon, and we assume that's universal. But in all the books I've read about childhood and hunter-gatherer societies, and nobody ever talks about angry teens. They talk about teenagers who are rambunctious and wild and full of energy, but that angry, sullen teenager that I certainly was is not a universal. That's not a part of human nature. That's, I think, very close to what Duncan was saying, that's when you come to an age where you're smart enough to look around and realize how fucked this is. You're angry. Of course you're angry. You thought it was going to be a party. Think about how our society moves. We move away from mystery as we get older, unless we're like religious nut jobs. We grow up like thinking, oh, there's Santa Claus and there's the Tooth Fairy and there's all this stuff. And as you get older, one of the hallmarks of maturity is knowing there's no fucking mystery. It's all just work and taxes and deal with your bullshit, right? You look at shamanic societies like the ones we all evolved in, they move toward mystery through their lives. They move closer to the rituals and the gods and the other worlds. It's a completely different trajectory. And so we end up depressed.
It creates connection and it creates humility. When you're worshiping the gods, you're not just worshiping the gods. You're also offering up your own humility that you don't compare to the gods. When you're experiencing a hunter-gatherer lifestyle, you are getting the exact programming and rewards that your body has been set up to receive in order to stay alive forever. We're in a transitionary period with our bodies because our bodies have all these reward systems built in, and there's no need whatsoever to feed them. There's no need to feed the fight and flight. There's no need to feed the hunter-gatherer. There's no need. You're going to the supermarket and you're getting your food. You're going to work by sitting down all day. Yeah. None of it makes sense to your body. Right. Your body is absolutely baffled. Right. And if you're not doing something that you absolutely love while you're sitting in that studio, designing something or art or whatever it is, I mean, you could conceivably obviously go to a job and it'd be the most amazing job ever. But if it's not the most amazing job ever, if you really are sitting there just doing nonsense that you don't give a fuck about all day, there's nothing like that in all of nature. Gathering food is exciting. Hunting is exciting. Fishing is exciting. Right. Planting crops is satisfying. If you pull a tomato off of a vine and you eat that tomato, there's a visceral, almost genetic excitement that you get from that. We're not getting any of those rewards all day long, but we're forcing ourselves to live in this way. It's not like living in a way where we would get those rewards would be impossible. It's just, it's not, society and it almost engineered itself to make it so that we can innovate and make new things easier and quicker. That's what society did. It pushed people into large groups. It's almost like the machine wants to be born, so it reprogrammed society to live for the machine instead of to live for its own need system, its own wants and desires, its own. If you could tell someone that you're going to live a finite life, this, you only have this amount of, let's manage that life and let's see how you handle it. How much time do you think you'd spend sitting in a fucking box doing some shit you don't like? You wouldn't. You would spend none. You'd put zero in the box. You would say, well, what percentage of your day do you want to sit down and do something you don't want? Zero. Okay, well, when you're engineering your life, you're engineering your life to live for your needs, to exist for what would make you happy and what would make you like a person who's feeling satisfied and feeling like you're thrilled by life. But that's not what society wants. What society wants is to make sure that your reward system is going to be based on material items, because if it's not based on material items, then we can't make more material items. We want to make sure that you always need the newest, craziest shit. So we're going to get you in a society where you're inundated by visual images of things that are way better than the things that you possess, and your main focus will be possessing those things because they will equate happiness to you. Of course, you'll never receive that happiness, because if you did, you'd drop off the game. If having a 69 Mustang was a thing that would make you really happy, always wanted a 69 Mustang.
Yeah.
You'd get that 69 Mustang and you'd be good. But it's not. You're done. Then you want a 70 Firebird. Then you want a this. Then you want a that. And you get caught up in this path of collecting items. This ensures that these items continue to get made.
Right.
So we're living our lives for this system more than we're living our lives for humanity. The system's tricking us.
Fuck, man. That was what my book was going to be about.
Spoiler.
Now I have to think of something else to write.
That is what it is, right?
That's an articulation of...
Right. We're rats on a wheel.
It's making us create itself. There's an intelligent life that's waiting to be born out of the human innovation.
It's already born. It's already born, and we are slaves of it. That's what this book is about. All this talk about Frankenstein and the singularity, whatever. Frankenstein exists. Frankenstein is the economic system that we are enslaved by in order to keep the economic system running. You're right. It's not designed for human satisfaction. It's designed to perpetuate itself, right? It's designed. Profit is the central engine in this whole thing. And like when I see a commercial that says, you know, like, we, you know, BP believes that, but BP doesn't believe anything. It has no brain. It's not a being. I don't give a fuck what Mitt Romney says. Corporations are not people, my friend. Corporations are artificial structures that have been set up that have taken on life like fucking Frankenstein monster, and they've turned against us, and now they rule the world. They don't give a fuck about the plastic in the ocean and overfishing and the cruelty to the fucking pigs and the industrial farms and whatever else. They don't care because they can't care. And this is the problem.
That's amazing. Do you know about Zerzan?
Primitive anarchist.
Primitive anarchist guy. And he says that the whole problem started when we began to use symbols to represent life. And then we got confused with the symbols and started thinking that the symbols were life. So that's the big problem, is that it's the Frankenstein, is that people don't experience reality anymore. They experience the secondhand reality composed of all these symbols that people have made that represent what reality is. Like the clock. Clock represents the sun. The clock is the sun. Hmm. We still worship the sun, but now we worship it in this form of like a recreation of the cycle of day and night that we put into a fucking clock, and we worship that fucking thing, and it modulates all of society. The pulsation of society is all based on the symbolic representation of the periods of light and dark that we exist in. That's not, the clock is not life. Life is the experience of being out in the sun, and it's going to be there for a certain amount of time, and while it's there, there's certain things you can do. When it's not there, there's certain things you can't do. But a connection to that light and not to the fucking weird sundial thing on your wall would be so much healthier. And there's so many other examples of these people getting addicted to the symbol of the thing, the symbol. Mm. You told me you loved me.
Right.
I said I loved you. I said I loved you. Don't you understand that? I love you. Then why are you acting like an asshole all the time? You know what I mean? You can't say I love you and then act like an asshole. Saying I love you does not mean that you love me. Completely embracing me and forgiving me and being in the moment with me, that's love, not some fucking sentence that you said. But again, once you get caught up in those fucking symbols, you're no longer, your feet aren't touching the ground anymore. Let me just finish this this rant by saying that the most tragic death I've ever heard of happened. One of the most tragic deaths. And it reminds me of this.
What am I hearing?
The coffee maker.
Oh.
This making guy... In this guy, this recently happened. Did you hear about this? The guy was like wanting to take a picture of the sunset and he electrocuted himself. Did you hear about this? This guy climbed up in a tree to take a picture of the sunset and he uploaded the picture of the sunset to Facebook. And then the next day they found him in the tree and he was dead because he touched a power line and he electrocuted himself. Now, if that guy had climbed up into that tree because he was like, oh my God, this is the most beautiful fucking sunset I've ever seen, and I just want to get closer to it. I just want to see this fucking sunset. That would be a kind of mystical, Rumi-level, Sufi poet death. You know what I mean? He wanted to see the sunset so bad that he died for it. But he didn't want to see the sunset as much as he wanted people to know that he had seen a nice sunset. There was this secondary thing happening.
Well, now they know.
Well, yeah, but you see, that's what we're all doing, is it's like we're not having sex because we are, some people are having sex because they want to like feel like I had sex.
Right.
You know what I mean? Some people, they don't want to go hiking because they want to be out in nature. They want to go hiking so they could tell people, I'm healthy, I go hiking. You know what I mean? They're not connecting with the thing itself. And that's, like, that's,
I mean,
the problem.
I go to fucking REI and buy a bunch of, you know, hiking clothes, and I rarely go hiking. I mean, you know, so branding plays into that, you know?
Yeah.
It's like your identity is you're a camper guy, or you're this guy, or you're that guy, whereas you're not living the experience, you're just dressing up as it, you know?
Yes.
Like the off-the-rack hippies we were talking about earlier.
That's,
you know, and
it.
Your thing that you were talking about being on the wheel and, you know, this whole rant that we're all on here.
Thank you.
Is that, do you think that's why hallucinogens are so heavily penalized in this country?
I think that there's always a push and a pull to life. There's always good and evil. And it sounds cliche, but I really do think that they may be forces of the universe that are what you would say, the way you describe as natural. There's two of them. Describe either one. I think that we look at natural behavior in other systems, whether it's bees, bizarre behavior like building honeycombs and gathering of honey and the infanticide that the female bees go and find the other female larva and stab them with their stinger. We look at all these things as just being completely normal, although very complex for these really relatively simple life forms in comparison to us. When you factor in human language, when you factor in culture, and then the fact that different languages and different geographic origins and people interact with each other and change each other and all, you have to think of it as natural. I mean, I don't see how it could be anything but. And if I look at it as natural, well, what is the thing that's going on universally? If I step away from culture, step away from language, and I look at this objectively, so objectively that I'm not even a human being. I'm analyzing it mathematically. What's going on here? It's making things. It's constantly making things. Not just things, but different things and more innovation every day.
But also destroying.
Sure. The process of making those things kills the mother itself.
Right.
That's universal. The process of making those things, whether it's through coal, whether it's digging into the ground to get minerals for an electric car, whether it's dropping off plastic in the ocean, whatever it is, during the process of this industrialized nation, it's destroying its mother. But it doesn't give a fuck about destroying its mother, because what it's trying to do is make something. It's trying to make some ultimate piece of technology, most likely a life form. The word on, like, if you talk to the people that we talked to when we did that 2045 conference,
yes,
those guys are all thinking that there's going to be artificial life. It's not like one guy thinks it, every other guy thinks he's a quack. They all think it. They all think there's going to be artificial intelligence that is so intense and so powerful that it's going to be able to be sentient, and it's going to be able to create copies of itself, and it's going to be able to improve upon whatever design it has.
So we're the larva stage of this being.
Yeah, it's alive, man. We just don't think of it as alive because it can't die like we do, because it doesn't have the same issues that we do as far as our body having a ticking time bomb inside of us, an expiration date.
So, I mean, do you think tadpoles get pissed off about the transition to frogs? Because, I mean, as a tadpole, if that's what's happening, I don't like this process. I mean, the fucking Earth was great, man.
It's still great.
Fucking it up. It's less great than it was before we got here.
I'm not sure. I wouldn't even want to think about that. I don't think you could stop it. I think it is what it is. I think it is nature. I think it's just like getting wet when the rain comes down. It's just one of the things that happens.
Well, certainly when Duncan was talking about Zerzan and his idea that symbolic intelligence is the beginning of the problem, I was thinking the same thing. Like, okay, but how do we avoid symbolic intelligence? We are, in our very nature, symbolic beings. There's no culture in the world that doesn't have language, you know?
Just get a little closer to the source, man. It's, for example, when you say that you've killed a bunch of people accidentally with your robot flying machine, don't call it collateral damage. Call it, we killed a bunch of people.
Yeah, but I mean, they were the enemy. You know, it's the same thing. But you dehumanize them in one way or another.
I think you can get, I'm not saying that we all just stop talking and wander around in some kind of like open-mouthed, gurgling, like, bliss state.
Namaste.
But second-hand meat factory.
Yeah, I'm saying we zoom in a little, just try to get a little closer to the experience itself, and then a lot of these things that we think are going to be great, which are just symbols, like what you're saying, a car, a nice house, all these things, these are just symbols. So we're seeking to obtain these symbols and forgetting that it's not the symbols that we want, it's the feeling they give us that we want. And
but is that like dragging your feet in the parade of history? I mean, because Joe, if I understand what Joe's saying, it's like that's where we're going. So maybe we should just say, fuck it, let's go.
Well,
just go.
I think
we should enjoy the moment. We should enjoy life. We should be really cool to each other. But I think this doesn't have to necessarily be a negative thing. I think all of history, as far as human beings, points to the fact that things get better. I think if you go back to the Dark Ages, if you go back, I mean, there's, you know, periods and times where people romanticize, but I say fuck them. They're crazy. Those people are all getting syphilis and fucking smallpox, and there's
I disagree on that. That's a fundamental disagreement.
Yeah, I love today. I think this is the greatest time ever to be alive, and I think the internet makes it so. I think without the internet, my life would not be nearly as rich and rewarding. I wouldn't know as many things. I wouldn't be in touch with as many people. I wouldn't be influenced by as many sources. I think the internet is.
You're happier living now than like the 60s.
Fuck yeah! Really? I wouldn't want to live in the 60s. How hard would it be to do a podcast in the 60s? It'd be fucking impossible. And they would arrest you if you said half the shit that we said during your commercials.
Yeah,
you know, all the shit that Lenny Bruce went to jail for. Yeah. Fuck that, man. I like being alive today, where all the forefathers have already done the work, and I, you know, I pick up where they left off.
But you're a kind of utopian. Chris, you're like looking to the past.
We're all utopians here. That's the funny thing. Yeah, we just locate it in different places.
Yeah. Where are you located, Duncan?
The utopia?
Yeah.
I'll tell you where, man. When I'm walking my dog from time to time, and maybe I've eaten a marijuana edible, and it's a nice day, sometimes I'll be, but maybe not, but sometimes I'll be walking my dog, maybe listening to like Jack Kornfield on my earbuds or not, but I walk down by the LA River, and every once in a while, man, it's like, oh, this is fucking great, man. And there's no reason. It just comes, you know, and it's like, this is it. This is what it's all about. Whatever this is, I love this. That's utopia to me. Now, that being said, I'll be the first in line to get a fucking android fuck slave robot thing when they come out. I'm not telling you I wouldn't have one of those.
When you say utopia, but that's not really new utopia because you're only talking very selfishly about your experience. Not very selfishly in a negative way. I mean self-centered. You're thinking about yourself, enjoying your time with your dog.
Yeah.
I don't mean that in any way negative. Selfishly is the wrong word.
Peak experience.
Yeah. But you're living in a crime-ridden neighborhood. There's poverty everywhere. The government's fucking you over.
And
we're
really,
involved in wars.
The LA River, is that a fucking river?
It's not even a river. It's a drain pipe.
It's a culvert.
There you go, friends.
Have you ever heard Honey Honey, the LA River? Have you ever heard that song?
Yeah.
That's a goddamn great song.
Yeah, man. Look, it's like I'm not going to – if I spend all my time thinking about the fucking chemtrails or the fact that there's dungeons filled with people – who are just trying to grow stuff out of the ground, or if I think about the, you know, 500,000 at least people have died since the 50s because of the United States government, or I imagine that I'm some kind of like hippie lice that somehow gotten into the scales of one of the most horrific dragons that have ever landed on this planet. You know what I mean? What's that going to do?
Yeah.
Is that gonna like really, like, all that's gonna do is, that's just a form of mental prostration to the Antichrist,
right? But that's still not saying that this is utopia by being in the moment. But your utopia would not be you being in the moment while chaos ensues around you. Your utopia would be the world getting their shit together and everyone becoming in the moment and just being cool to each other. That would be your utopia.
And guess who that starts right? with you.
Yes, it does.
That starts with you, and it ends with you. And that's it. It starts with you and it fucking ends with you.
Unless the Russians invade.
Yeah, the Russians. Oh, they're so hot, man.
Bring them
I
on.
Can't stop thinking about that girl at the spa. That would be utopia, too. The point is, man, you start with yourself. That's the idea. You work on yourself. You decide, all right, God damn it. Whenever I can, I'm going to just try to be in the present moment as much as I can. I'm just going to be here. I'm just going to be here exactly the way that I am right now. Just start there. If you're scared of chemtrails and cops and the pigs and the fucking Satan living under the planet or all this shit, then that's fine. But it just be in the moment of being scared. And I think the more people start doing that and stop looking outside of themselves to try to find some kind of peace, tranquility, something, a nutritional bar, fucking testosterone creams, or a goddamn helicopter that you can fly in, whatever it is, the more you start believing that the dragon is going to make you happy, the more you're just a little satanic materialist sucking on that black nipple of Baphomet, trying to get another fucking dopamine rush from whatever little plastic configuration you've bought because you think it's going to take away the pain that comes from knowing you're going to die. It doesn't work. Get into yourself, and then you can really enjoy the stuff. Then you can enjoy the fucking helicopter. Then you can really enjoy the stuff until you, like, figure out how to be in the moment. Well, how are you going to be happy? If you're not in the moment, then you're not driving in the car you bought anyway. You're off in the future, or you're off in the past. You know what I mean? You're thinking about fucking robots coming down from the sky and a perfect spaceship being built by this incredible species that we are. You're thinking about people having these beautiful jungle orgies rolling around in some fertile rainforest surrounded by everything they need. It's like, what about here? This is where we're at.
Yeah, well, I'm not thinking about
I'm sorry, Joe, when I said that, I'm sorry. I don't know why I said that. What you're thinking about is like a very beautiful thing that's like Terrence McKenna, the idea of this incredible invention that's about to happen that we can all feel. So I apologize.
No, no worries, but I feel like I try to live in the moment as much as possible, and I fully embrace the idea of a finite life, and I fully embrace the idea that it's easy to take friends and loved ones and situations for granted, and you should be as thankful and as gracious and as happy as you can. I mean, like, when I say I'm a happy person, I'm a happy person because I've been depressed. I'm a happy person because I've contemplated the nature of this thing, and I'm trying to figure out what's to my best interest. My best interest is to make a fun ride of it all, you know, and just enjoy it like I'm in a simulation, like I'm someone who comes from a sexless, drugless, muscle carless future who's completely bored by enlightenment and the everyone's sat-nam and everybody to death.
Yes.
And it's just boring. No one's getting their dick sucked. There's no horrible music that you can scream, this fucking sucks.
Yes.
Justin Bieber exists so that you can get angry at him. All this stuff happens so that you have something to go fucking crazy for. They're part of the thrill of this existence is the fact that it's imperfect.
Do you think
there's
he really
beauty
got smacked?
In imperfection. Fuck yeah, he got smacked. You can't talk some shit like that to a fucking professional athlete.
What's that story?
The guy was in the Clippers. He comes in with his fucking pants hanging down by his ankles, starts yelling at some counter lady because she wouldn't serve him when he has no shirt on. And the Clippers guy came over to calm him down. He started getting stupid. And the guy's like, what, bitch? So what? The 7 foot tall man you're talking to, Junior. You can't fucking do that. That guy, just nature, just DNA itself guided his hand to that boy's face before he even realized he was doing it.
Exactly.
He's like, I'll fucking kill you. You better watch your fucking tone, Junior.
Is there a video of that?
No, of course not. It's probably like a security video somewhere. Fucking kid needs a slap. And I would need a slap too if I was him. Everybody would. That's an unfair experience.
Doing him a fucking favor.
It's an unfair experience.
Yeah.
Being a guy who's that young and that famous and that rich is a completely unfair experience. We couldn't imagine it. You have told me yourself how weird it is when people come up to you out of nowhere and you're like, whoa. And you're a fucking grown man.
Yes. Yeah.
Could you imagine being a 19-year-old boy who has never known anonymity, by the way?
Plus the money.
Oh, staggering amounts of money. Yeah. Like $500 million worth of money.
Right.
He has literally unfathomable wealth. He's so fucking rich and so famous that people see him. They can't believe they're meeting
fucked.
Him.
You could, in the back of your head, you could always just think, you know what? I'll just find a very small country in South America. I'll buy it. I'll militarize
it. That's not out of the realm of possibility.
That's what I'm saying. He could militarize his own country.
Could you imagine if that happens? If he becomes like one of the world's great dictators? It's like we're joking about Justin Bieber at 19, but Justin Bieber at 36 has a fucking Fidel Castro beard and mustache, and he's, you know, he's living on the top of a hill, this giant compound. He made $70 billion in music and decided to start his own economy, running solely on Bieber coins,
and there's just a trickle of teenage girls still coming in on rafts.
He's like Genghis Khan. Like everyone has his DNA.
Yeah, exactly.
He fucks them all.
Or he could just buy an aircraft carrier and set it up in international waters.
Oh yeah,
I know someone is doing that. Actually, they're working on that project.
I've seen that. Those guys are gonna get killed. No one's gonna let you set up a country in the middle of the ocean. Everyone's gonna go after them.
Well, you know, they're smart though. You know how they're starting it.
The Green Berets.
They're starting it as a medical a place where you can go and get cheap medical care. And so it's like it's a separate country. It's in international waters, but they're starting it off like you can go there, get all these surgeries and blah blah blah, and it's cheap and it's a short flight because you're not flying to Thailand, you're just flying off the coast.
That place is going to be surrounded by nuclear submarines just floating underneath it under the water. They won't even know. There'll probably be 30 nuclear submarines around.
Here's my take on it: military people retire every day. Soldiers, Navy SEALs, Green Berets, Rangers retire and want out every day. You scoop them up, give them exorbitant amounts of money and mushrooms, take them through a very thorough training process. You respect them for their service and their bravery, and let them know about this new thing you're starting off the coast. And everybody starts from there. You build up a well-armed force of really cool people who happen to have missiles. And then, otherwise, you're not going to work. It's not going to work, man. The United States ain't going to buy it.
Before we move too far away from utopia, I just wanted to add a little trivia here. Do you know what the word actually means, the roots of the word utopia?
I Googled it once, but I forgot.
No such place exists.
Really? Is that what it really means? Yeah.
That's awesome.
Perfect.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Yeah. Yeah,
it's a struggle, like though. There's, you know, we were talking about this yesterday, that life is... The beauty in life comes from the ugliness, and that there is the struggle is not just natural, it's essential. It's a really important part of the process. You appreciate love when you've experienced hate. You know, I remember like having situations at school where like, you know, me and someone had gotten into an argument or something like that, and then being alone kissing my girlfriend, like how much more powerful it seemed than this horrible emotional experience of yelling with someone. You know, some guy yelling at me and me yelling at him. And then the difference between the contrast of that, of being alone with a girl and she's kissing you, and it's like, it makes you appreciate it more. It's like, I think if we were all beautiful peace, love, and happiness, and there was no crime, and everyone was super cool and kind, we would just take it for granted. We would be like spoiled rich lottery winners.
Justin Bieber.
I mean, we are.
We are, in
you
a
know,
way.
That's where we are. And I remember I had this apartment in Barcelona, my first apartment in Barcelona. It was a rooftop. It wasn't even an apartment, because the way these buildings are made, like you've got doormen who live there. So the doorman lives there. Downstairs by the door, he's got his kitchen and his TV and hang out and all that. But he sleeps all the way up on the roof. So they have these tiny little apartments up on the roofs of these old buildings. And now the doorman lives somewhere else, so they're just sort of empty. So I rented one of these things. No kitchen, toilet, sink, that's it, right? And a room. That was all it was. So I set up this outdoor shower. Like I got a thing from a restaurant where cooking oil came in it or something. I painted it black and put it on the roof of the thing so it would absorb the heat, and set up this whole outdoor solar power thing. And But in the winter, it never got hot enough, right? So the only way I could bathe was I would, I had this little camping stove thing I'd bought with two burners and a little butane thing. And so bathing would be like a two-hour process. I'd put on this big pot of water and, you know, heat it up and then pour that into a bucket and then pour in the cold water and get the right temperature. And then I'd squat over the drain in the bathroom and, like, do my pits and my ass and everything first, you know, and go through this whole process. And it took hours. Like, while it was heating, I'd read and do stuff. And then there was that moment where I've washed all the essential parts and I've got my hair all soapy, and now I just take the bucket and pour it over my head. That, I still get fucking goose pimples when I remember that moment. It's such an enjoyable, pleasurable moment. Now, you know, I walk in the shower, turn on the hot water, boom, there I am. It's easy. It's great. But like you say, I don't feel it the same way. Because the process is what makes you feel it.
That's right.
You know, that you enjoy resting when you've worked out.
Yeah.
You enjoy eating when you're hungry. Yes. You enjoy sex when you haven't had it for a while.
I would tell you about my favorite shower ever. I went hunting in Montana for 7 days on the Missouri Breaks, the same path that Lewis and Clark took.
When they were really? This is just recently.
Yeah, last year.
Yeah.
We were out there, you know, the warmest it got was maybe 30. Like at noon, maybe it got 30. Most of the time it was like 9 degrees, and we're just chasing deer, and we're sleeping on the ground. We're sleeping in tents, and we're, you know, most of the time we're eating shitty food, and we're, you know, you're dirty, and you'd get sweaty from climbing the hills, and then freeze your dick off because it was so cold out, because your clothes would be damp, and then they had to warm back up. It's like horrible, okay, but awesome. So 6 days of that, and then finally we got to Anchorage. We got back to Anchorage, successful trip, had these deer with us in these coolers, and everyone like so thrilled that we'd gone through this crazy experience, and I finally get a hot shower. I'm in this, you know, fucking Anchorage Inn or whatever the hell this shitty hotel is, and it didn't matter. This stupid, like, weird color yellow tub and shitty shower curtain. Who cares? That water was hot and glorious, and just lather and feeling the dead skin scrape off of my body as I rub my balls and my legs and my feet. It was glorious. I took an hour shower.
Yeah.
Brian Callen was with me. He did the same thing. He said that we both got together. The first thing we said was, "That's the greatest shower I've ever had."
There
in my
you
life.
Go, man. That's it.
It's like if you fuck every day, three times a day, you get numb to what fucking is.
Yeah.
Take a couple of weeks off and then be with someone you're really hot for.
Isn't this the idea of fasting? Like, you guys are kind of, it's like fasting, you know, like if you want to like just cleanse your system, go a day without eating and then eat the next day and look how good it is.
See, this is why I locate my utopia clearly in prehistory, okay? Because all these mechanisms that we're talking about were built in, right? You went hunting when you were hungry. And because people are naturally lazy, you had to get pretty hungry before you'd actually get up and go hunting, right? Unless you just really enjoyed it or whatever. So hunger's built in. Satisfaction's built in because you killed that thing. You went out and got it, and people are happy. You brought it back to camp. Everybody loves you. You know, all these mechanisms that we're talking about trying to recreate where we can in our lives, that's where they all come from, you know?
Right.
And so that, to me, that's why, you know, obviously not utopia. I know it wasn't perfect. I know there was all sorts of nastiness, but there was no syphilis. There was no gonorrhea. There was no tuberculosis. All those things came from domesticated animals. There was no tooth decay.
Oh, so you're going way back.
On prehistory. He yeah. Pre-agricultural.
Going,
right.
12,000 years? How long are you going back?
Before 10. Yeah. 10,000 years ago was the first evidence of agriculture anywhere in the world. And then it arose subsequently independently in different parts of the
Did
world.
Did they update that at all because of Göbekli Tepe?
No. That's Turkey, right?
Mm-hmm. So sorry, I got to pee.
No, I think it's about 10,000 years.
Göbekli Tepe is 12,000 years old, giant concentric circles made in stone, 19 feet high.
Yeah, and they're not really sure what it was, a community center. I mean, that is evidence that a large number of people were getting together, but they don't know why,
right.
And they don't know whether they were hunter-gatherers or you know.
Yeah, they actually still assume that they were hunter-gatherers, which is really weird.
Right.
But I always wonder if that's because they wanted to fit into a specific timeline.
Well, I think they didn't find any evidence of agriculture there.
They didn't find much evidence at all. What they found is just these stones and pretty positive evidence that it's all been covered up.
Right.
We had Graham Hancock on the podcast talking about it, and he was talking about that they've carbon dated the soil. It's very unique in that it's uniformly 12,000 years old. So they're pretty sure that 12,000 years ago, for whatever reason, they decided to cover this thing up.
Mm.
So that doesn't even really say how old it actually is. 12,500 years old, 13,000, you know, who knows? But I think that I agree with a lot of what you're saying, and I agree with that those times probably had those reward systems built in. But those things are also available today. But the things that are available today that weren't available then are amazing. Not just medicine, not just glasses, not just computers, not just planes, not just the internet.
Right.
I mean, everything. I mean, fucking life is incredible now. Going to a restaurant, ordering a bottle of wine. All these things are amazing. Yeah. Going to the movies.
But
getting
but
a
nobody's
video
happy. Everything's amazing,
that's not true.
But nobody's
happy.
No,
you can
I'm
be
quoting
happy.
Louis
Some
C.K.
Happy. Oh,
you yeah, know that, yeah, that yeah, bit yeah. he did, right?
Well, Louis is a bit more of a curmudgeon than I am, I think. And a very funny guy, and I love his comedy, and I love him. But I'm happy, and I think you can be happy too. I think most people are unhappy because of the way they're choosing to live their lives, or whether the way they've been stuck in the momentum of the past. They're stuck in this life, whether it's geographic, whether it's their education, whether it's they have a family to support, they can't quit their job. A lot of people are just stuck because we make bad decisions. I've made bad decisions and recovered. Some people make bad decisions, and for whatever reason, circumstance, just poor luck, they don't recover. I mean, there's a lot of life is a crapshoot in that regard.
Yeah.
But I think that there's just as much potential for good life today and to live along those same principles as there were then. You know, why aren't rich people starting their own farms? Why aren't rich people growing their own food? I think it's amazing that I have a neighbor who has a fucking Rolls Royce, but they don't have a single vegetable growing in their backyard. Like, why wouldn't rich people spend the time to start planting food and like developing a relationship to those needs and human reward systems of the hunter-gatherer that we already have built in. Even if it's just the farmer, the gatherer, that's a deep, really connected feeling when you're eating kale that you grew. You're eating that salad. That salad tastes amazing.
See, the problem is that very few people have the wherewithal, whether it's intellectual, psychological, financial, whatever, to live in a way that's in conflict with the values of their society, right? Mm-hmm. We have all gotten away with
it. Great way of putting that.
Yeah.
But most people, you're going down the river, they're not going to swim against that stream. They can't, right? So the values of our society, as Duncan was saying, point toward all these plastic doodads and all this bullshit. And you're saying, yeah, but people could choose to do something else. And I agree with you. And I think if they choose to do something else, a good place to look is in prehistoric societies, because that's where these triggers came from. That's where the triggers toward happiness and satisfaction and all that, and nutrition and exercise. But the problem is, very few people can do that. Mm-hmm. So when you look at a hunter-gatherer society, those people are living in congruously with their society, with the values of their society. They're in a shamanic society. Mm-hmm. They've got these coming-of-age rituals. They've got, you know, people aren't designed to work out, right? We're lazy. By nature, we're lazy. So what works is if your life requires you to walk 10 kilometers a day, right? Then you do it, right? But if you have to, like, you know, I know you're big on discipline, and that's, discipline's great. It's something I don't have much of. Otherwise, I'd be like a rock and roll guitarist at this point, or a concert pianist. But, you know, you need discipline to do that stuff. In a hunter-gatherer society, you don't need discipline because that's just what everybody's doing.
That's interesting,
I think that's why you're happy all the time. I think it's I mean, not to reduce it, I think you're brilliant, but I think a big part of it is you exercise all the time. And anytime I'm getting all gloomy and fucking shitty, it's always like stunning if I just go run 5 miles, how it's like all that shit's gone.
Right.
And you're like, "Oh my god, I feel fucking great."
Yeah, gone.
Yeah, gone. Yeah. Like it just presses reset somehow, and it's like it bothers me every time in this weird way, because it's like this is it.
Right. Well, it shouldn't bother you. What you just need to do is just learn from it. Learn from it, and it's got to be a part of your mind. It's a part of my mind. If I have an issue, if there's something going on, there's two places I go to. I go to the tank, unless I want to smash something, then I go to the gym. And the gym in the garage, like if I'm annoyed at something, I go to the gym in the garage, I have a heavy bag set up, I turn the TV on, I turn the music on, whatever I do, and I hit the timer, and I just start doing 3-minute rounds until I want to die. I start slow, I build up a good sweat, and then 5, 6, 7 minute rounds in there, I'm fighting for my life, smashing this punching bag like I'm going to war, like I'm fighting for my life. And then after an hour of that, dude, it's over. I'm lying there, there's puddles of sweat everywhere, I can't breathe, my heart's about to pound out of my chest. And then I stretch out, and then I'm done, and you can't fuck with me. Like, then you couldn't say anything to me that's going to bother me. All it's right. not possible. There's nothing that's going to, like, hit a trigger that shouldn't be there. There's nothing that's going to... Mm. But until I do that, until I blow all that shit out of my system, until I feed all those mechanisms that are designed in my body, you build up this accumulated excess energy. And this excess energy starts fucking with you. And you start thinking about all weird, random shit in your life and attaching meaning to yeah. things that don't have any meaning and giving, you know, all sorts of credence to other people's opinions and all sorts of shit that really shouldn't affect you at all, but it's because your body's trying to stimulate motion. Mm. It's like, go kill that motherfucker. I need to work out. Like, that's what it is. It's like your body's trying to trick you. Man, that fucking guy's talking shit about you, dude. I don't think you should take it. This is what I would do. I'd run up to him. I'd just fucking keep hitting him until you're tired. You know, your body's trying to trick you to exercise right. those old reward systems yeah. that are built into it. Just do them yourself. Yeah. Do them yourself. It's a part of life. Do it like brushing your teeth. You have to brush your teeth. You have to work out. If you don't, you're going to feel weird. Just realize that. Know it. Embrace it. And then the other one is the tank. And that's another thing. I think schools should have tanks. People should have tanks in their fucking homes. I'm disappointed in both you fucks. You don't have tanks.
I don't have a
especially
home.
Especially you. You got a new place and you didn't get a place that could fit a tank. You're crazy.
I can fit a tank.
You're free. There's... You need to get a tank tomorrow, Duncan. You should have had a tank
listen,
last year.
Song of the Millionaire is what I call it. No!
Don't make me tell these people how much money you have, you fuck. Don't you
the
pretend.
No.
By the way, Crash would hook you up with one for free, I'm
Crash,
sure.
Crash, if you will hook me up with one for free, I'll...
Bah, pay him, you fuck! The guy's got a business.
Me too, Crash. Me too.
Support him. Thefloatlab.com.
I'll have an...
Fucking guy makes genius products.
I'll have an apartment soon. It's gonna need a tank.
I want a tank so fucking bad.
Why don't you have a tank? You don't want a tank so fucking bad.
I've never even been in a tank. That's how bad I am.
You're ridiculous. You need to get in one. It doesn't make any sense. The fact that you're 52 years of age and you haven't experienced that. It's one of the most underutilized and underappreciated inventions in human history. And it's just too weird for people, so they steer away from it. You can get the only tape you get away from the world and away from your own body and into your own mind.
Right.
It's the only environment like it on Earth.
But isn't that what you do every night when you sleep?
No way. It's
I mean,
totally
I lie
different.
There. I'm in my head. I don't even know I have a body half
that's,
the time.
You say that, but I mean, I'm telling you, the experience of no body, the experience of being conscious, but being in this tank of water that you don't feel, floating through the universe in total silence and total darkness,
yeah.
it's not something that you can minimalize or recreate with a bed.
Right.
You can get a good relaxation out of a bed. You can get a good feeling out of a bed, but you're not going to get that tank. I just know you would love it.
Yeah.
I'd
love
overly,
to do it.
This tank,
sorry if I'm overly
here's
enthusiastic.
The thing. No, it's worth being enthusiastic. Ask about because it's weird. That's one of the big cool things.
You
about
think
it.
It's going to be boring.
You're
it's
opening
not.
Up this fucking rectangular entrance thing. You open it up and then you like slide down into this like just blackness. You know, it's weird. It just automatically starts out weird. Like it is. I mean, to have a tank and then to have like weed and edible marijuana and psychedelics on hand. You understand, it's one of the most, it's like you're sliding into this psychedelic little trap door into nothingness, and then you float there, and it's really cool. I do know why you like it so much, man. It's fucking weird and cool, and definitely, it's a form of meditation, really. It seems to be like a type of meditation.
Can you get into the fetal position? Is there enough space?
No, you're only going to lie down.
Just lie down.
You just want to, you want no body. The problem with the fetal position is you're going to be floating weird and feeling you feel your own body.
Yeah.
You don't want anything in your body. To be touching anything else in your body. Arms and legs spread wide. That's one of the reasons
really?
Why Crash is so genius, because everybody was building these really narrow tanks and you would touch the sides. Crash was like, is that my phone? This Android phone, I love it, but it does weird shit sometimes, man. It just starts playing music and I don't know why it's playing music.
What song is that?
That's Gary Clark Jr. You ever listen to Gary Clark Jr.?
No.
You don't know who he is?
No.
Dude. My ringtone is Hey 19 by Steely Dan. Not that I'm a pedophile or anything. I just like the way it starts.
What was I just talking about? I totally lost
the wide tank.
Oh, wide tank.
Crash builds them 6 feet wide. 6 feet wide and like 9 feet long. Like he builds them for basketball players so that you get in these things and there's no chance of touch. Even if you do touch the side, you just have to like gently push yourself away from it. Not too much and maybe even stabilize yourself. And then once you get into the center and there's no more motion in the water, you just spread your arms and legs, and go flying.
And you're actually floating.
You're floating. Half of your body is above the water.
That's because of the salinity of the water?
Yes.
Right.
1,000 pounds of Epsom salts. So it's really good for your skin. It's one of the best ways to absorb magnesium. Right. It's actually good for your health. It actually relaxes you in a very real physical way because of the magnesium. It's great for your muscles.
So you can't change the water very often.
It goes through massive filtration.
Oh.
Way more filtration than, I mean, he has this incredible setup with ozone and all these... come over to my house. I'll show you the whole
thing. Yeah, I'd love to.
You need to come. You can get in the tank. I'll set it. We'll do it one day. Come over the house during the day.
That'll be my birthday gift from you.
Yes,
thank you. Oh, what a cool birthday gift.
Or you could go to the float lab anytime you want. It's in Venice.
It's
the best place in the world. This guy figured out a way to make these incredible tanks. They have oxygen that pumps into the tank while you're in there. So you're getting like this real fresh air. He's a fucking genius when it comes to these things. And the innovation that he's done at the float lab, it's so much more advanced. It's like everyone else is still driving a Model T, and he's got a $19 million Ferrari. I mean, really, it's there's no $19 million Ferraris.
Damn.
I don't know why I said 19.
What would that be made out of?
Diamonds.
Yeah, I guess so.
Of course. Of course, diamonds.
He basically has like the most intricate, the most complex, the most advanced sensory deprivation tanks in the world. These giant, like, freezer doors. Like, when you shut it, it's like thump. It's like this big, thick metal door. Like, the whole thing is genius.
His name's Crash.
Crash, yeah.
This episode is brought to you by Crash at Float Lab.
He doesn't pay me anything.
Yeah.
I give that guy all that attention just because, A, he's awesome
it's
at what
cool.
he does. He's a cool guy. I really like him. And I think the sensory deprivation tank business is it's a business that's like really missing a lot of advertisement and promotion. And it's not represented by how awesome it is.
What do they cost? They're
steep,
expensive. Right?
They're expensive.
That's why.
A Samadhi, I think, was like, I bought a Samadhi tank first, and I think that was about $5,000. There's other tank manufacturers that are coming onto the market now that are selling them for a little bit less because they're realizing that there's an actual business for this, and people are kind of innovating and taking. Look, for a long time, there was no business. There was Samadhi, and that was it. And there was a couple companies in Europe, but there was nobody that was building or selling sensory deprivation tanks. But since I started talking about them within like the past decade and a half, the business has really gotten much, much bigger. There's many new float places that are opening up all over the country. They send me emails. Thank you for talking about this. Now I own a float business, and I'm benefiting my community. All these people love it. I'm changing people's lives at this place. It's incredible. You get alone with yourself in one of those things in a way that you can't get anywhere else.
Yeah. Well, that sounds great. I mean, alone with yourself is a good place to be.
Yeah, this is the Vice documentary. Well, Hamilton Morris came to my house, and then he went to the float lab in Venice. This is him in my basement. We did a podcast, and we fucked up because we got way too high. Way too high. There's no way we should have been talking on the air.
Oh, really?
We were like 8-9 hits deep and just fucking confused. And every sentence out of our mouth was confusing. I'm like, I'm here with this Hamilton Morris guy who's this psychedelic adventurer. Like, we're going to go deep. Let's just go so deep. But we went way too deep. We totally overmodulated. That's the podcast. And his voice dropped down to like cartoonish depth. It was hilarious. He's a cool guy. Very, very cool guy.
Yeah. I think I told you guys the story about the last time I did a heroic dose of something and I ended up wandering under the grounds of a psychiatric hospital.
You told me.
Yeah. Well, I won't tell that story again. But yeah, I mean, every time I think about like going, let's just go for it, I remember that.
That's
it
why
started.
You have a sitter. You need to have a sitter.
Yeah, my sitter bolted. He had other
I'm
stuff
out of
to
here.
Do.
Fuck this man. I'm out for number one.
Well, I was lying under this tree, like, you know, communing with nature, and he was like, I gotta move, I gotta walk, I gotta do something. So he took off.
Wait a minute, was he on mushrooms too?
Acid, yeah.
That's not a sitter.
Well, you know, we were just a couple of guys, you know, wandering through the woods. Yeah.
That's like a guy who's gonna be your designated driver, but he's doing heroin.
Yeah.
Well, you want your sitter to have a very small dose of whatever you're on. That's like the classic formula is you have actually it's three people. So it's the person who's like taking the dose, who's like there to learn. Then it's somebody with him who's tripping with him, who's on the same dose, or someone who's like on sort of the same dose. And then there's the sitter. They compare it to an air traffic controller. And so he's on a very – basically, he's the person where you ask him if you're dying.
And he says no.
No, you're not dying.
Not yet.
But that's like kind of the model for it. I love that model. That's super cool. It's but to make that happen, man, that really takes a lot of organization.
Yeah, way too much. Way too much. In our case, it was just, I mean, I'm lying under this tree and I'm like feeling the vibrations of the tree. Have I told you guys this story?
No.
And so I'm you know, it's this beautiful tree and, you know, you're looking up through the leaves and the sky and the muscular branches of the tree and I'm feeling it. And then I start feeling like I can pick up the vibrations of the tree, the energy of the frequency. And when I pull my own frequency into alignment with the frequency of the tree, it's like I have a like a brain orgasm. Like it's just this like incredible pleasure. And it's so intense I can only stand it for like half a second. And then I pull myself out of sync with the vibrations of the tree. And then, but it was like, wow, that was incredible. And then I go in again and holy shit. And then I pull it back out. And I keep like going in and out of sync with this vibration. And then like, I don't know, after an hour or something, I'm like so spent. Like, okay, I got to get up. I got to move. So I get up and I stumble out from under the tree and I hear this buzzing sound. And I look up and there are high tension power lines right above the tree.
Whoa.
I thought I was like making love with nature and I was getting raped by technology. That was the beginning of a bad experience.
I remember this story now. Yeah. I remember this story.
That's
now.
Like the story of how like a supervillain gets made in a comic. Yeah,
exactly.
And then I became Electricity Man.
Well, the guy who went to take the photo of the sunset or the sunrise, whichever it was, got electrocuted.
But it, right.
But couldn't it, I wanted to comment on that, but I didn't want to interrupt your rant. Wouldn't it be possible that guy just wanted to show everyone else how beautiful it was and still enjoy it and make art? By taking a photograph? Like, why does it have to be? The reason why he died was that he was trying to fucking capture it. Why can't he just experience it, man?
There's definitely a sweetness to it, for sure. There's no doubt. And he was, like, a really sweet guy. And that's what makes it tragic. I mean, it wasn't all just like, he's like, I'm going to get a lot of likes on this. It was... it's that combination of... It's just that thing. You know, man, something that has stuck with me is when you were talking about your DMT trip once, you were telling me about it. And you were saying how you recognize there's a part of you that's always trying to capture the thing. Do you remember saying that? Mm-hmm. I can't articulate like you.
There's a part of me whenever I describe something, I'm not just describing it. I'm also describing it and trying to make it sound good, which gives me a reward. It gives me I get an ego reward for a carefully articulated sentence, which is why one of the reasons why I think it's so when someone's unaware of that. And they speak in such pretentious, self-absorbed terms, it becomes really annoying because you're watching a guy jerk off. I mean, that's what you're doing.
Yeah.
And when I did DMT, it was the first time I'd ever realized that everything that I say, whenever I describe anything, it's almost always at least partially flavored by ego because you're trying to describe these things in a way that makes you seem cool. Or in a way that makes you seem smart, or in a way that makes you seem like you could turn a clever phrase.
Right.
And the DMT experience wouldn't let me do that. It wouldn't let me take any credit for any words. It wouldn't let me change them or harmonize them in a way that'd be more appealing. It didn't want any of that. It was like, stop, what are you doing?
Right.
Like, you see what you're doing here? Like these clever phrases you're doing, these orchestrated rants, these you know, entertaining as though they may be, you're doing them for ego. You're doing them for a little reward. You're trying
symbolizing them.
Yes.
Right?
Which that's is what you're I'm talking saying, about. Man. Yeah. It's that thing where you're like, you're in this beautiful moment. And instead of just being in the beautiful moment, your mind is already going to like, fuck, man, wait till I tell Joe about this.
Yes,
fucking.
Yes.
So now it's like you're digitizing. Essentially, you're digitizing the moment so that you could get the ego boost you get from somebody being like, holy shit, that's crazy, really?
Yeah.
And that's fine. I mean, it's so fun telling stories and relating what's happened. But anything that's keeping you from like. Fully being there.
Yeah, that's why I don't take camera. I used to, when I was traveling a lot, I had a pretty nice camera and I used to like sell photos to magazines and calendars and shit, you know? And I don't carry it anymore just because I realized when I got more into it, I realized like you're either traveling or you're taking pictures.
Yeah.
If you're taking pictures, it's not, people think like, oh, you're in a beautiful place, take a picture. No, you're in a beautiful place, you say, ah, that's a beautiful scene right there, that at 8 o'clock in the morning is when that's going to be lit, right? If I stand up on the rooftop of that building right there, you have to set it up. It takes a lot of work, and that starts to dominate your experience. Mm. And then the sun comes up and there are clouds, so you got to come back tomorrow and the next day and the next day. That's what photographers do. That ain't travel, you know? That's a completely different thing.
Isn't there a comfortable medium, though, where you pull out your phone and take a picture of something that's beautiful?
Yeah, sure. That's what I do now, yeah. But that's like, hey, if I happen across it, then cool, and I get a little creative. But if it takes more than 2 or 3 minutes,
Just don't be the fucking paparazzi, man. I have friends where I feel like I'm around the goddamn fucking they just want to take it. They want to document every moment. It's
all
like,
food.
Just stop. Stop documenting everything, goddammit. Where the fuck are you? What are you? No one cares about this. And like, in 20 years, we're all going to be slaves to some kind of robot machine god anyway.
Yeah. So talking about this translating, this cheapening experience in a way by getting too much into the description of it, one of the things I've been toying with, like my editor and friends and people write emails and stuff, encouraging me to tell travel stories, right? Because I traveled for 20 years.
You're good at telling those stories.
Right, but I shy away from it because of exactly what you were saying, that I don't want to come across as some guy, I don't want to be some guy who's just jerking off over like, oh yeah, when I was in India, man,
you don't
I
have
did
to
this.
Worry about
like,
that. You wouldn't. You, first of all, you've lived a fascinating life and you have these experiences to retell, and people love that. They love hearing those. I love hearing stories of travel. People love hearing that. They love hearing interesting stories.
Yeah, I guess.
It gives them nothing but pleasure. It's a great thing.
Yeah, and they don't have to listen to it if they don't want to. I was thinking like set up a separate sort of podcast category or something.
Why?
For that.
Well, dude, just do it, man. Listen, you shouldn't worry about being pretentious because you're not pretentious. You shouldn't worry about being a douchebag because you're not a douchebag.
Right.
It's like you're just not. So you shouldn't think about it. Like, there's
aren't you not pretentious because you worry about it?
No, I'm concerned that I could ever possibly someday become so. So I will analyze and I will look at what I do. But I'm generally, my intent is to always go towards the path that's not pretentious. I fail. We all fail. You know, especially when you're ad-libbing and you're trying to concoct things, whether it's on stage or whether it's in a podcast. There's times where it just misses.
Sure.
Your brain fires wrong. You're tired. Whatever. Fill in the blank. You ran into a dead end with the idea that you're on. But for the most part, my intent is to just relay the information with as little ego as is humanly possible, what I'm capable
of. Right, right.
And you're the same way.
So you're conscious of it.
Yeah, I mean, you're just going to tell your stories in an honest way and tell what your unique experience was. Like, what was interesting about it to you? What was your perspective? Right. Don't shy away from that at all. I don't know why you would.
Yeah. Some people need to be telling the stories.
Yeah, they're great stories, man.
I just don't want to be that guy, you know, at the party who's always telling the story. I don't know. Yeah.
You'll get over that shit.
So back to your bad show. I mean, this is kind of related. When you were talking about that bad night.
After Phil died?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like when you're on stage, do you ever, I mean, I guess it's breaking some rule, but would you ever just say, fuck, I'm sorry? You know,
no,
a friend of mine died.
I would definitely. I didn't say that to them.
Because you'd fuck it up for the other guys who were coming on after you,
exactly.
wouldn't you?
Yeah. Exactly. I got to the end and I was starting to apologize and I realized I was just going to make an excuse for myself eating shit. And I just said, I'm in a fucked up place right now. I'm really sorry. And I just brought up the next guy, but I didn't tell them the story.
You didn't tell them why.
I was thinking of telling them the story, but what a... fucking insanely selfish.
The next guy comes on.
God.
Thanks, Joe.
Yeah. Massive bummer. And it just insanely selfish. Just to relieve myself of responsibility for my terrible set, I would tell you about this woman who was about to murder her children until the cops broke in.
Yeah.
And the children ran away, you know.
Yeah.
No, I don't think so.
But have you ever done that? Have you ever been on stage and like just broken it and be like, look, you know, I smoke too much. Or I don't know if you guys smoke before shows, or I feel like I'm gonna like shit in my pants here. Have you ever like?
I've never
had
a shit in my
thing?
Pants, but I mean, if you smoke too much, I mean, I've joked around about having a problem because I smoke too much. But most of it is just joking around. Like we've gotten on stage high many times, and sometimes I'll say I just need a bookmark in the audience. Like anybody, if I feel like I'm forgot completely what I'm talking about, I'm just gonna point to you and you go tomatoes. I'm like right tomatoes, and I go and we'll be fine. But it's more of a joke than anything. But if there was something where I had to address it, I would just address it in the moment. I would try to address it as as honest as possible. I think you have to. Yeah. If you don't, you're gonna lose it. You're gonna lose that connection. If they think you're lying to them, or they,
right.
The whole thing about comedy is obviously in the performance there are jokes that are lies. They're just supposed to be funny, and but the intent is never a lie. The intent is always just to entertain and to make people feel good.
Right.
That's always the intent. And I think if you try to change what's going on or try to bullshit them, they're going to smell it. They're little animals, little sensitive little animals out there in the audience. They smell weakness.
Yeah.
You got to own up to it.
What do you guys think about Andy Kaufman? You admire him?
We actually talked about him the other day on a podcast. We had a whole podcast. We dedicated a whole thing to his bizarre performance art. And I said that I thought it was a really unique way of entertaining people. Like, what he did was weird, but it wasn't stand-up. It wasn't like, I don't like to be a purist, you know, I don't want to be say that that's the only thing that I think is funny, because it's not. I think a lot of things are funny, but I think that what he did was really bizarre and unique. The wrestling with women and the, you know, the getting on stage and singing Here I Come to Save the Day like 100 times in a row. It was weird. I mean, he was trying things out, you know, and some of them were interesting or more interesting than others.
Yeah.
Did you see that guy who infiltrated the TED Talk?
No.
What did happened? You see it? That Ted's been trying to get it taken down. A comedian convinced Ted that he was some kind of something or another, and they let him give a fucking talk, and the whole thing was like a giant put on. And
about what? What was the subject?
Can you look that up? Can we put that? Look, I'm going to. We just have to play this, man.
Well, describe it so he can give
so
an accurate Google
search. Basically, there's a comedian. I can't remember his name. He somehow convinces Ted that he's like, I don't know, some kind of entrepreneurial something. What's the name of it? What's the name of the talk?
Sam Hyde is his name.
Yes. So he comes out wearing a plastic chest plate. It's like he's just scamming Ted, and he starts doing this like regurgitated bullshit like you hear on the TED Talks. And he's really kind of like, he's really roasting the crowd, because he gets them all to like pat themselves on the back. But no, man, play it. Look at this.
This sounds like the Yes Man.
Oh, this is but the guy. Play the intro, because you know he wrote this intro. Can you start
the
it
beginning?
Oh, and he's Indian too. They love that.
No, that's not him. That's the guy.
His work spans every continent and has been featured on television and in print, Discovery, Nat Geo, Vice, and others. He recently returned from Mogadishu, the most dangerous city on earth, where he shadowed the heroic El Mahmoud women on their quest to clean up the streets and restore humanity to their war-torn country. I present to you Sam Hyde, 2070 paradigm shift. Sam.
Oh my God. Look at him.
Can I have this water here? Is this anybody's? I'm claiming that right there. All right.
He walks through the stage, so that's great.
You got to see what this guy looks like, here. Folks. I'm just getting the audio of this.
Oh, good. Okay. So keep that on me. Otherwise, you guys can't hear me.
That's right. A lot of people are only.
Give me like 25 seconds here.
Getting the audio. He's sitting on the stairs.
Dressed like a gladiator with a sock cap on. It's a weird outfit.
Give me like 10 more seconds.
He's just doing performance art here. He's pretending that he's an awkward guy.
Oh, man. This thing. Can we turn this up a little bit so I don't have to like turn my head into it? Can you? How about now? Test. Hey, there you go. Yeah, I'll talk to you later. You're doing a good job. Oh, man. Okay. Can we reset the clock so I have another minute extra? Please?
Oh, this is great. This is a TEDx thing.
Okay, hey. I wanted to start sitting down anyway. Guys, pat yourselves on the back right now, okay? Let's do it. Come on. Everybody, I'm not going to let you stop until I see everybody doing it. Let's pat ourselves on the back. There we go. You two, you're patting each other. That's cheating. You couldn't keep your hands off her, could you? Yeah. Hey, I don't blame you. She is cutie. Hey, guys. That pat on the back right there is for saving the world. I'm looking at young minds right now. You guys are all intelligent. I know that you did good in school. I didn't do that. You especially. You're very smart. Look at us. We're the machine that keeps the world going. Okay? I'd like to start this talk off with a parable, a story, if you will. I was at a college, a second tier, not an Ivy League school, a second choice school, and I was in a class, and there was a student in that class, okay? And the teacher, he was spouting some horrible nonsense about how it was something about how women's rights are not legitimate, something that everybody knew was false. But if anybody had spoken up, he would have taken extreme joy in failing them. Okay, nobody spoke up. One person raised his voice. One person started talking. The teacher couldn't believe it. The classroom couldn't believe it either. But in the end, he had logic on his side. And at the end of the day, he proved his point. That student was Albert Einstein. In that same sense of...
He could not laugh.
He's laughing at his own shit. He's hitting himself in the face
that
now.
Same sense of childlike play.
Well, let's let it's pretty long.
Goes on forever.
What is the name?
Sam Hyde.
H-Y-D-E. H-Y-D-E.
You know, my TED Talk's going up in a week. A week from today,
congrats.
My TED Talk's finally going up.
What happened? Didn't a woman write a book called Sex at Dusk, like refuting what you say?
I got an email from her.
Yeah, I know. You sent me the email.
What was her argument?
Well, first of all, here's how that thing happened, okay? Our book comes out, people start writing reviews on Amazon. Every time somebody writes a positive review, within 24 hours, this person, Lynn Saxon, is there saying, no, you don't understand, this book's full of lies, it's full of lies. Like, really committed to stamping out any sort of enthusiasm for our book. And so after a while, you know, first I think, okay, whatever, people have, you know, right to their opinions, fine. But she's like on a campaign. It's like really insistent. So after a while, I think, okay, I'm going to engage with this person and you know, just so that there will be a record of me responding to some of these accusations, right? Because it's not just they're wrong. It's that, you know, he's an idiot. He doesn't understand anything. He's lying to you. You know, it's like personal ad hominem stuff. So I go in with my sort of Aikido approach to things. And I'm like, okay, you know, you obviously, hey, you know this material. That's great. I respect your knowledge. But, you know, here's the evidence for this and that. And, you know, we're not lying about that. We're not misrepresenting the facts. There is this tribe here that we cite and this and that. And after we go back and forth maybe 15 or 20 times, and then I realize, like, you're never going to change someone's mind who thinks you're a lying idiot, right? So I say to her, you know, I don't know why you're spending so much time here on Amazon. You should just write your own book. So he did. Now, the reason I keep playing with the pronouns is nobody really knows if this person, Lynn Saxon, exists. Several people have written to me saying, hey, I've tried to find evidence of this person ever existing anywhere before this thing happened, this book came out, and we can't find it. So I don't know. I personally don't know whether she exists or not. But then there have been like reviews of the book written by people who may be Lynn Saxon. So who knows? It's all very mysterious.
You just gave too much energy to a crazy person right there. You just tapped into the vein.
I know. But you asked me, you know, so there it is.
That's how it works.
Yeah. And, you know, and it's weird shit. Like my mother gets phone calls in the middle of the night from people saying she should be ashamed to be my mother.
Wow.
Both my current and previous publishers have received phone calls from people saying that I plagiarized the book. I'm planning to plagiarize my next book. I mean, all sorts. There's like a defamation campaign. You know, people are threatened. People are freaked out. So anyway, I don't know if this person exists or not. I haven't read her book. I've read some stuff she's written, and I, you know, have seen the structure of the critique.
Wow.
Which is another thing that I'm hesitant. I was thinking of doing a podcast where I respond to this stuff. Because you know, I don't have the time to sit down and write it and make it perfect and go back and, you know, consult the books that are now in storage in my ex-girlfriend's house in Spain. But I was thinking just, you know, respond to it. But again, I don't know whether I don't like being in the space of the defensive author, you know, and I don't know, if it's really worth the trouble. You know?
It's definitely not worth the trouble. It's not true. You're talking to a crazy person. You tapped into someone who needs attention. And once you do that, you give them legitimacy by continuing that.
It's a form of trolling, you know,
yeah, you
essentially.
Got trolled.
Yeah,
you got trolled, so.
And you're feeding the trolls. Yeah. So, yeah. I don't know. And on the other hand, it's an honor that someone took the time to write a book-length critique.
No, yeah? It's a crazy person. Crazy person tapped into you because she doesn't want her husband fucking a bunch of chicks. That's what it is. She got her fucking assholes. Probably not
There's
even
a lot of
want
anger.
Husband.
That's the problem. If there weren't so much anger, if it were just a, you know, hey, I think you're wrong about this or that, then I would respond.
What is her, well, fuck it. Who cares? What is the, let's push that aside, but what is the main thing that people are upset about when you say that people call your mother or they email someone that you know and get angry? Like, or publicist or whoever it is, what is the main argument against you? What do they say?
Well, it tends to be personal. It's that I'm a liar and I'm plagiarizing. I mean, I got an email from a guy in Germany claiming that I had plagiarized a line in a paper that he published in 1976. I don't read German, by the way. And the line was, "We didn't descend from apes, we are apes." He read that in our book.
Oh my God, that's a crazy person.
Yeah, exactly. So there's
that's a scientific statement.
And it's not even that original a line. And, you know, to think that I read it in a paper that came out in some obscure German journal in 1978 or whatever, it's like, come on.
There's no getting away from crazy, man.
Yeah.
It's out
there's
there.
There's no way.
There's no getting away from it. You can't dwell on it.
Yeah.
Did you guys see that dumb Starbucks?
Yes. Isn't that hilarious?
Fucking great. Did you see
that? I haven't seen it. I heard of it. But
a comic who has a show on Comedy
Nathan
Central.
Nathan Felder.
He created a new company called Dumb Starbucks, and by the rules of parody, just by putting dumb in front of Starbucks, he's allowed to use the Starbucks logo and sell coffee under the name Dumb Starbucks.
They don't sell it. They give it
they
away.
They give it away. Oh,
he released a YouTube video. Did you see his video?
I watched him on one of the guys, Jimmy Kimmel. Yeah.
Can you play his YouTube video? That's it's great. Really cool because he did a special video from the store wearing a Starbucks outfit. It's very.
How do they give it away?
What they well because it's clearly for his show on Comedy Central, which is very funny, which is where he goes to businesses that and poses as a business expert and gives them like he went to an ice cream store and told them they should have a poop flavored ice cream and like they do it. It's really funny.
Do you guys know the Yes Men while we're talking about this? Oh, they're fucking great.
That thing where they were talking about poop turning back into cheeseburgers?
The Reburger. It was the Reburger. Yeah.
You got that thing, Jamie?
I was trying to find the official one.
Yeah, because if you don't on YouTube, there's all these assholes where you think it's going to be the video, and then it's like some weirdo giving their commentary on it. Those things are so
annoying.
Yeah,
I hate that shit.
Those so pretentious. People standing in front of the camera and talking about shit. And the weird ones are the ones that are like hyper-edited. They're edited like every couple of seconds.
Yeah. Oh, right, yeah.
They remove like any dead air, like after conversation.
They made me really nervous.
This doesn't happen. There's none of this.
Yeah.
It's all quick.
Been getting a lot of buzz on social media.
Hold on, you have two things playing at the same time.
Located in Los Angeles, oh, wait, will you start it again?
Start from the
beginning. By adding the word dumb, Hi, I'm Nathan Felder, president and founder of Dumb Starbucks, a brand new coffee experience located in Los Angeles, California. By adding the word dumb, we are legally allowed to use the coveted Starbucks name and logo because we've fulfilled the minimum requirements to be considered a parody under U.S. law. We have a full menu, including all your favorite Starbucks items, a delicious selection of pastries, and even some music for the ride home. Many of you probably know me as a comedian, but this is no bit or joke. This is a real business I plan to get rich from, but I need your support. Our flagship store is located at 1802 Hillhurst in Los Angeles, California. Come in and get a free coffee on me. Just say Nathan sent you.
No, they sell it, dude. He's just giving away a free coffee.
No, they were giving it away. And all the write-ups about it, they were saying that they were giving it away.
But there was prices on that board.
I read everything I read that was that they were giving.
They can't sell it.
Oh, they can't sell it.
Yeah. Because legally it's a money-making operation, then they can get a cease and desist. Right?
So he's just going to give away muffins and coffee?
Yeah.
Well, the LA board wanted to shut him down. And he's facing 6 months in jail because of it.
Seriously?
Why?
Because it's illegal to just start selling, quote unquote, selling coffee.
So he's giving it away because of that? So it's a short-term proposition.
Yeah. Yes.
Well, listen, guys, am I still driving the bus? Should we wrap this up?
Well, you can if you want. I mean, it's 2:14. My next podcast not until 3, so we can hang out for about a half hour. So
whatever. Yeah. You have more things to talk about, Duncan? You have a rant you've been saving up?
And that's why.
So I'll tell my TED thing while you're reloading. My TED Talk's coming out a week from today. They finally told me why, because the New York Times contacted me. They're writing a story about TED. The New York Times contacted me about this story. And then I wrote to TED. I said, hey, the New York Times contacted me. They want to know when this thing's coming out. And then they're like, it's coming out in 2 weeks.
Of course.
Yeah.
That's what we were talking about before we got off on the Starbucks thing. We were talking about people getting upset at you. We were talking about what is the plagiarism thing? But what is the other? Are there any disputes about the data or the conclusions?
Well, okay, the argument that this Lynn Saxon person or people make is essentially like they say, okay, our argument in the book is we say humans are not by nature monogamous. Here are a whole bunch of reasons. Some of those reasons are anthropological, some are from primates, some are from human anatomy, and some are from contemporary psychosexual research, right? Porn and the way people go to therapists and complain and all this. So the anthropological stuff, what they say is, okay, we cite all these societies, probably 20 or 30 societies around the world that are not monogamous, right? And part of our argument is that if our ancestors were not monogamous, that fits into a sharing economy that we know hunter-gatherer people have and our ancestors have. They share food, they share childcare, women breastfeed one another's babies. And so paternity was not that big of a deal, as is argued in the sort of standard evolutionary argument, right? That men want to know that those babies are there, so they'll invest in that baby and blah, 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 right? We're saying, well, that's based on a contemporary capitalist vision of economics where you invest in your children because you own the house and you have the diamond Ferrari. But in hunter-gatherer societies, all these things are shared. So it doesn't, why would men only worry about investing in their own children? They don't even know whose children they are. A lot of these societies practice what's known as a partible paternity among anthropologists, meaning that they think that a baby can have several fathers. Right. So a woman who wants to have a kid who's smart and funny and good looking makes sure she fucks the smart guy, the funny guy, and the good looking guy to get all their essence into her baby, because she thinks that a fetus is made of accumulated semen. Right. There are lots of societies like this around the world. So we cite all these different societies as evidence that humans are not by nature monogamous. Then what the critics do is they go back and they say, oh, but look at this society. You know, this society, you know, the women get raped. Or in this society, you know, he doesn't mention that a lot of babies die before they reach adolescence and da-da-da. These aren't, you know, utopian perfect societies. Yeah, but we didn't say that. All we're doing is saying these are examples of societies that are not monogamous. Therefore, if you're arguing that monogamy is a human universal and built into our DNA, look at all these counterexamples. We're not saying these are examples of prehistoric life necessarily. We're simply saying these are examples of societies that shouldn't be organized this way if monogamy were built into our DNA.
So what you're doing is a scientific analysis of the known data on human sexuality and culture. And what they're doing is an emotional reaction to what they perceive to be a threat against monogamy.
That's how it looks to me. But that's why I don't really want to get into...
Yes.
Because it's emotional.
Yes.
You know, when our book came out, Megan McArdle in The Atlantic wrote a review where she trashed it. I mean, she said it reads like horse feathers was her. Then she said, one of the things she said was like, how can you write a whole book arguing against monogamy, which we don't do. We're not arguing against monogamy. If you say humans are omnivores, you're not arguing against vegetarianism. Right? You're just saying it's tough. And this is why it's tough, because your nature is not that of an herbivore, right? Anyway, she said, how can you write a whole book arguing this without even discussing jealousy? Chapter 10 is called Jealousy, you know? So it's like...
She didn't even read it.
Right. That's emotion.
Ah. Oh, that's so gross. What's her name again?
Megan McArdle. She's an economist.
Shame on you, Megan.
Yeah.
Shame on you.
There's a review of Sex at Dusk in the journal, the Chronicle of Higher Education by this guy, David Barish. He says he doesn't say plagiarist. He says we misrepresent data. We don't understand the first thing about evolution. Just like every trash you could throw at us. Not a single example.
Wow.
So it's like, how am I going to respond to that? You know, I'll be attacking a sad person. I don't want to do that.
Right.
So, but it's weird because I get a lot of emails from people saying, you don't even respond. Like, you know, what are you afraid? You know, blah. I'm not afraid. I just don't want to get in that, the mental space I'm in right now. I don't like it. You know, the book's out there.
Right.
It's true. It's not true. That's not up to me to decide.
You don't want to do like one of those debates, like between
Ken Ham and the or whatever his name was, the creationist and the scientist. Yeah, I don't see how that can really be debated. You know, like I'll debate a scientist who thinks, you know, well, you're evidence of about the bonobos is inaccurate. Well, you know, the world's leading expert on bonobos doesn't think so, but we can debate that.
Isn't that debate kind of weird? It's like debating with somebody who believes in Santa Claus or something like what?
Yeah.
But I guess debates like that are important because they get information out that maybe could change people who have adopted false information.
Fence sitters. They're important for fence sitters. They're important for people to consider contrary ideas and then maybe even eventually accept them. I mean, so how many people have had like really rigid belief systems?
Well, before I saw that debate, I believed in evolution.
How many people are like that, where they've had these like really rigid belief systems, and then over time, many pieces of evidence accumulate and break down their wall, and they start to reconsider other possibilities? With religion, it's really common, right? It's one of the most common things. I have friends that I've talked about them before. They were Mormon for most of their life. Now they're in their 40s, and they're like, now what? They abandoned Mormonism, and they're like trying yoga and all kinds of other shit, but it's fascinating to watch them sort of like...
That's the problem, because the mind forms in the presence of certainty, you know, and then it's very difficult to take that same mind and exist peacefully without some sort of certainty.
They become very fundamentalist, even in their thinking about other aspects of life. Like I found a lot of people that are Mormons or, you know, like strong Christians, but then abandon it. One of the things they do is they start really believing in the government and really believing in a no-nonsense approach to life. They don't want to consider any possibilities outside of the mainstream ideas. They're shy away from anything even remotely silly, like whether it's psychics or whether it's conspiracy. Even in the face of overwhelming evidence, they'll avoid anything that leans towards government conspiracies or people conspiring. When that's just as ridiculous as believing in all of them. Believing in all of them is ridiculous, but believing in none of them is just as ridiculous. Believing that people have never conspired is equally ridiculous, but it's a fundamentalist type of mindset. Right. So they go from fundamentalist, God is protecting you and the Bible is his word and you must follow every word of it and then you will go to heaven, to, okay, that's all bullshit. You know what else is bullshit? Pollution. You know what else is bullshit? This giving you cancer. You know what else is bullshit?
Yeah,
they become skeptics. Yeah. They become like a skeptic isn't necessarily an objective thinker.
Right.
They lean towards skepticism and cynicism almost exclusively. And people will argue that, like, you don't understand skeptics. They get all angry and fucking...
They do get mad.
Very angry when you question skepticism.
Yeah.
The skepticism is unquestionably important. Don't get me wrong. But there are many people that when they pretend to be skeptics. What they really are is fundamentalist contrarians.
I was on a podcast called The Ardent Atheist a week or so ago, and I found myself in the strange position of defending religion. You know, because the host, and really nice people, the host says, so we're all atheists here around this table, right? And they all looked at me, and I was like, well, no, I wouldn't call myself an atheist. And it was like I'd farted in church a little bit, you know, and
they're little kids. They're getting off on using that word.
Well, certainty.
Like, we're being.
I don't like certainty.
I don't like. I think it's a atheist. Certain atheists, not all of them. Certain skeptics, not all of them, have a very surface level approach to things. And fundamentalist has a very surface level approach to things. A fundamentalist takes the symbols of the Bible and believes that's what happened.
Mm.
An atheist then begins to argue with the fundamentalist's interpretation of the thing as literal. And begins to say, look, I can fucking prove to you there's no talking snake in the Garden of Eden. I can fucking easily prove that. How's a snake going to talk? It doesn't have a mouth that could talk. And it's like, don't you realize what you're doing?
Yeah.
You're believing in the surface level in a different way by refuting it, where it's like, you think that snake snake, that story's about a talking fucking snake.
Right.
You really think that's what it's about, or the Garden of Eden is about a fucking actual garden? You really believe that?
Exactly.
That's a deep, deep, deep story about what it means to fall out of happiness, or what it means to get out of the heart, or what you can. There's so many. It's a fractal that goes in and in and in. But if you want to fucking separate smart people from dumb people, create a situation where people who only see things on the surface are going to avoid it or misinterpret it, and that the people who recognize, like, shit, there's something in here that's way more than any of these two camps are seeing, that would lure the smart people in. And that's why when you look at cathedrals, and that's why you look at government buildings, you see these strange stone symbols carved into those fucking things, because they're winks from the people who, like, who created that those symbols, I think, you know? Mm. And those people are the Illuminati, and I want to join.
Just putting it out there, folks.
This Duncan podcast is brought to you by the Illuminati.
The Bilderberger Group.
Speaking of certainty, what do you guys think about, in light of the Philip Seymour Hoffman situation, what do you guys think about addiction? Is it a disease? Do you buy the disease theory?
It's a physical addiction. Physical addictions are a disease. I mean, it's an ailment of the body.
You think so?
Yeah, 100%. There's without a doubt a psychological aspect to it. Without a doubt, people being impulsive, people get addicted to things that are not physically a chemical that you're introducing to your system. But it is a chemical because it's your body in changing state. It's your mind changing its state of consciousness.
But your mind is always changing state.
Right, but you're addicted to a specific type of changing of state. And it might be the dirtiness of going to a peep booth. It might be gambling. It might be getting addicted to a state of risking everything you have on one roll of the dice. And if you win, and then you get addicted to that. It might be, a chemical that you, an extra chemical outside of your body that you introduce.
Have you heard Stanhope's joke on addiction, on AA, on the disease?
Well, yeah, he says things you like more than you like life.
Yeah, he said maybe some things are better than life.
Yeah, but that's not true, because people want to quit those things. I mean, obviously Stanhope's just doing a bit, but people want to quit those things, and you can't, like, Amy Winehouse died because she got off of alcohol. That's why she died. She died because she quit and her body wasn't ready for it, and it went into shock and she died. She didn't have any other drugs in her system when she died.
Someone told me she'd Googled her own name like 1,000 times the night she died. Have you heard that?
Oh, God. That's horrible.
Worst night. You're having such a bad night.
She has 3 teeth and 2 of them in her pussy, and she's Googling herself. That's not a good night. And then you die. Fuck. A lot of shit went wrong there.
Yeah.
That's horrible, man.
Yeah, imagine the images of her stumbling out of nightclubs at 5 a.m., in the dawn's light, on heroin, half a tit hanging out of her shirt. I mean, how many of those were out there? There's so many of those pictures out there.
I'd much rather be addicted.
So you think it's self-hatred? She
could be many, many, many things, but it's also a physical addiction to alcohol, which is real.
All right, so since we're getting dark and deep here, how long... We should probably have like a pool. How long is Justin Bieber going to survive?
Forever. He's going to be the first guy to have the money to be immortal.
Yep.
And that's when he's going to be the overlord.
He's going to merge with the machine, man.
You don't think he's going to spin out into Michael Jackson strangeness?
Could be. Well, I don't think there's a roadmap to the territory that he's traveling on. And I think that's a real issue. Because even the people of the past, whether it's Elvis Presley or Michael
William
Jackson.
William Randolph Hearst.
Well, I'm talking about famous people who went crazy, who were pop stars and idolized. Hearst never had that issue.
Well, he went crazy,
yeah,
right?
But he didn't have the issue that these guys have. These guys have, what I mean by they're in new territory, they have a very specific issue being famous. And that is incredibly weird, where everywhere you go, everyone freaks out when they see you. They can't imagine it's really you, and they want to touch you.
Do you deal with that at all? Have you been in that?
Only at the UFC, but people get over it pretty
quickly.
I'm going
to stop you there. Only at the UFC. Once I was walking down the street with him on Sunset Boulevard, and fucking, I've never seen this before. You are the most famous person I ever hung out with, still. And I remember walking down the street, cop cars, as we're walking across the street at the Comedy Store, cop cars pull in, and they're like, Joe! Joe! Like, cops are stopping to talk to him. Anywhere you go. It's not just the UFC. You're being modest. When you wander down the street, Joe, 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 Joe. You just didn't, like, you didn't get puffed up. It didn't seem to really poison you in the way that it, like, crushes some people. But some people get really freaked out. He definitely has that thing.
It's a different thing, though. Like, I can go to the airport, no problem. I go through the airport. It's never an issue. And if people see me, they just say hi. It's not like a Justin Bieber thing. What I'm saying is that his stardom is almost unmanageable.
It's unrelenting, yeah.
The territory that he's traveling on, because of the fact that we live in this era of the internet and cell phones and Twitter, being able to send pictures and videos and video him on your phone everywhere he goes, he's in completely uncharted territory that Elvis didn't have to tread through, that Michael Jackson didn't have to tread through, but he's in the same level of stardom that those guys are in, or at least...
But can't he just, like, put on a fucking hat and sunglasses? Can't he get out of... See, that's the problem. He doesn't want to.
He's a boy. He's a boy, and he's not going through any rite of passage as a man. Instead, he's been labeled a king. He's Joffrey with a backwards baseball hat on.
Somebody's gonna do that meme and post that. Make sure you
that's what it is.
Twitter that shit.
It's not normal for a person. Yeah. You know, when I became famous, I was already a man.
That's a big difference.
I had been a martial arts champion. I had done very difficult things in my life. I had been a stand-up comedian and pursuing that for a long time. Where it is a constantly humbling job. You're chipping away at yourself all the time, and you're constantly assessing your performance. This guy's just singing songs that somebody else wrote, and everyone wants to suck his dick.
You've got a picture of Elvis right behind you.
Yeah.
I'm thinking there was this BBC documentary on the Beeble, on the Beebles, on the Beatles.
Beeble.
The Bieber.
The Beebles.
That's what they're going to call them, the Beebles.
That came out maybe 20 years ago. It was fantastic. It was like a 6-part thing. I don't remember what it was called, but they interviewed each of them, the surviving Beebles, and talking about the same experiences, and they were in completely, you know, like George Harrison was in Hawaii, and, you know, someone else was on his boat on the Thames, and Paul McCartney was in Manhattan or something. And they were talking about the same experiences, and they told the same fucking stories, like down to little details, same. And they just integrated their stories, and it was so beautiful. And they were talking about when they came to the U.S. and they were like riding that incredible wave, and they came out to L.A. and Elvis invited them up to his house. So they go out, the limo takes them up to Elvis's house, and they're like freaking out. That's fucking Elvis, you know, and they're still, what, in their early 20s, I guess. And they go, they hang out with Elvis for the day, and, you know, they played, he had a piano, they played some songs and sang together and hung out, whatever, and then they left. And I guess Elvis was pretty weird already at that point. And they got in the car, and they looked at each other, and somebody said, I'm so glad we're doing this together, because that's what happens if you have to do this alone.
Whoa. God damn, I would have loved to hang out with Elvis back then.
Me too.
Oh, I would have loved to just be in his presence and see how crazy he was when he was eating like 50 pills an hour.
But see, now if you were with Elvis, okay, you're doing a guy karate. Who's like been there a little bit, okay? My impulse when I'm around someone who's famous is to just treat them like a normal person. Mm-hmm. And I think I'm doing them a favor somehow. Like, you know, finally, someone who isn't, you know, oh, yeah, Elvis, oh, Joe, oh, whatever. I met Peter Gabriel, and I treated him like a normal person, and I think it weirded him out. I feel really bad about that.
Why would it weird him out?
Well, I don't know. I think he was just like after, because we spent like 15 minutes chatting together, and I never really mentioned his music at all, which I fucking love. And he's like,
why would that be weird?
Maybe just because it happens so infrequently. I don't know. But he looked at me like, dude, like I think I creeped him out in some way. And I feel bad about it because he's like the public person I most admire in the world. And I never said, like, dude, I love your music. I, you know, thank you so much for, you know. And I could have, like, mentioned obscure shit so he would have known, like, I really know his work. And I just didn't get in that space. Like, we just chatted about his kids and where he lived. And, you know, like, I know a guy he went to high school with.
Huh.
And we talked about him, you know. And so I just dealt with him like a guy. And at some point he looked at me like, who the fuck are you anyway? You know, it was a weird kind of look. And then I just felt strange.
Then what I got out of that is that Peter Gabriel is a closet douche.
No.
See, that's
he's holding it back. But he wanted you to worship him.
That's the problem with being, I think that's probably the problem with being that level of famous, is the interactions that you have with people.
They just can't be natural.
They're just you're having normal interactions with people throughout the day. Like today, I went and got eggs, and somebody brought a latte to me. And you know, if I'd been in a bad mood and for whatever reason said something off, and I'd been Justin Bieber, Peter Gabriel, then that person, who knows what's going to happen? They're going to call their friends and be like, you know what? Fucking Peter Gabriel came in here today. When I brought him his fucking latte, he acted like kind of a dick.
Yeah.
Whereas, like, if I'm in there, there's no story about that. It's just another. That's the problem with being famous is that everything that you do, if you're slightly off, I imagine, then what can happen is all of a sudden, tweet, ran into blah, 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 the blah, 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 and what a fucking dick. It's
but you don't even have to do it. Yeah. Someone can just make that shit up, and there's nothing you can do.
Well, that's
that.
Definitely happened. I had an issue where a guy invented a whole conversation in an elevator. We met in an elevator, and it was one of those things you get in an elevator. He didn't invent a conversation. We got in. It was me and Eddie and a couple other guys. We got in the elevator, and I guess maybe the guy said hi. I thought if someone says hi to me, I always say hi back. I don't know what happened, but when the guy was leaving, like maybe he said bye. I forget what it was, but there was no interaction at all, and it was definitely not someone ignoring him. He went on this message forum and went off about what a douchebag I am, and I think I'm so fucking tough, and you should see the way I act around fans, and like all this crazy shit. I was like, this was a complete non-event, like nothing happened, but. And he completely apologized for it after my description of it. And to this day, like sometimes he'll post on the forum and apologize for this one instance where he wrote something on a forum about an elevator. But it's a natural inclination to see someone who's famous run into Justin Bieber and want to talk shit. Like, that's the gravity, like, is to talk shit, to go, I ran into that Justin Bieber. I would have fucking smacked him, too, if I was in that fucking Starbucks. Yeah. He's a little cunt. Like, look at that guy, Blake Griffin. Happen. It didn't happen. No. Damn it. Fucking world has got no, there's no overlord. There's no God. Damn it, I hope he did. I hope he didn't. Justin just doesn't want to admit it.
But that's what we
want,
man.
Open palm that bitch right in the face.
The whole thing's a fucking it's like an S&M fantasy story, which is you take this little princeling, fatten him up, get him nice and egotistical, and then you get the head of the knights to spank him underneath the castle in front of everybody.
Yeah. Even better, you let him loose and you hunt him down.
Hunt him down, let him go.
Let him loose in the woods. We have decided to let the king go.
Yeah.
We will give him 20 minutes.
Scamper king.
For one day, you can hunt the king.
Yeah, he dominates 364 days a year, but one day, you get to hunt him.
And if you catch him, you become the king.
Yeah, but you gotta get close. Spears, no guns, just spears. Guns are too easy. You can shoot some from a mile away if you're a real sniper.
Yeah.
Spears.
You have to drop from a tree onto him and knife him. Yeah.
Drop from a tree and knife him.
Yeah.
Ooh. Leave Justin Bieber alone. That poor sweetie. Somebody just get him some acid.
He is a kid. Who knows what's going to happen?
Why don't
to him?
You invite him to your flotation tank, Joe?
Yeah, he needs a lot more than that. But he's, again, uncharted territory. And I don't think that anyone could really appreciate, even someone like me who's experienced being in the public eye for a long time, I don't think that I could ever experience it at that level. It's a different kind of level. It's unmanageable. It's way too crazy.
It makes you very wealthy in a currency you can't really spend.
Huh. That's a good way of looking at it.
You know, what are you going to do with all that fame?
Well, for him, he's constantly selling records. And he's got
money he'll never spend, you know?
But he does spend it. I mean, he buys Ferraris. He lives this crazy, lavish lifestyle. He had this. I mean, he's definitely doing something with all that money. Gets private jets and smokes weed on them. You hear about that? They're investigating him. Because they smoked weed, so much weed, the story was that the pilots had to put oxygen masks on while they were flying the plane. Which, I'm sorry, I'm on his side, if that's how he's rocking it.
Can you imagine, man, if you brought down your own plane?
Because the pilot's too high. It's like I'm freaking out, we're going to the mountain, man!
Are those chemtrails? No, that's Justin's plane. Yeah. It's like a Cheech and Chong movie, you know?
That's hilarious.
Have you ever met Mike Tyson, by any chance?
Yeah.
Really?
Man. Yeah, there's a picture of me and him together on Instagram.
No shit, really?
It was crazy. He goes, yeah, you that weed dude.
Really?
You're into weed, man. I've seen your videos. Yeah, it was hilarious. You've seen my videos on YouTube.
He seems like a sweetheart.
He's a very nice guy. Very, very nice guy.
I haven't seen the HBO thing you did, but he just seems like talking to a child, Justin Bieber, uncharted territory. Holy shit, man.
Well, he's a guy that, I mean, you want to talk about uncharted territory. He did the one thing that is probably at the top of every guy's list. He became the baddest motherfucker on earth. The number one, without a doubt, baddest man on the planet was Mike Tyson. When he was the running heavyweight champion,
no
he was
doubt.
The reigning king. He's the scariest heavyweight of all time.
No socks. I mean, you reminded me when you were talking about those dudes in Siberia. Like, Tyson was just so
no
hardcore.
Walk-in music, man. He would just walk to the octagon with a fucking evil look on his face.
Like an executioner.
Just walk in, jump under the rope, get a towel over his neck, no robes, nothing fancy.
Wow.
Nothing, just murder. We're here for murder. You know, we're not here to fucking put tassels on our shoes. I'm coming at you, son.
Yeah.
As soon as this white guy's done talking, I'm gonna fuck you up.
Within a minute, you're gonna be on the ground.
Terrifying. Yeah. It's no one could understand the ego behind that, or the managing that position of power, or what it must have been like star wise too. Because again, you're talking about before the internet, with very little accountability for your actions, because people couldn't say, oh my God, Tyson just, you know, did this. So you had to, like, bring in the police.
Yeah.
Like, you know, like, for order people to get an accurate reading on what happened to you, cops had to be involved.
Yeah.
You know, like, the guy, he had to punch some guy in a Harlem haberdashery, Mitch Blood Green, and broke his face up, and the guy was all fucked up. I mean, some cops got involved, so we found out that Tyson did that. But if it was today, you'd be getting videos all the time of him just being on rampages everywhere, doing all the wild, crazy shit that he did. You know, there's some, because they were following him a lot. You know, there's some of him, like, wrestling with his tigers and shit. Charlie Murphy has a great fucking story about going over Mike Tyson's house, and Mike Tyson had a tiger. He told it on the podcast. I think somebody made an animated clip out of it. See if you can find the animated clip, Charlie Murphy talking about Mike Tyson.
I love his story playing basketball with Prince.
Yes.
Jesus Christ, that's a hilarious
Prince
story.
Is a badass basketball player.
and he still had, like, the ruffled shirts on and all that when they're playing.
Yeah, Prince is a big chemtrail believer.
Really?
Oh, yeah, there's a video of him online.
And he's in fucking Minnesota, and Chappelle's in Ohio. What's with these guys?
What is this?
Listen to this.
When you see a man, it is cry.
Fucking incredible.
Cry when he reflects on parts of his life.
This documentary.
A strong man like that, you have to realize that whatever was on him was no joke.
Yeah, it's incredible.
Right? That's a man who one time I went to his house, and it was six limos, and nobody would get out the limo. And I said, how come nobody's getting out the car? They said, you don't see that lion standing over there? Mike Tyson had a lion in his front yard.
Like Hangover style.
That's the only man whose house I ever went over. There was a lion in the front yard, loose.
Wow.
And he was on the steps like this with a heavyweight belt.
He's on the steps with his belt? What?
That'll protect you.
What?
How come nobody wants to get out the car and play with my cat? He's like, no, man, no, that's not a cat. That's a lion.
That's fucking real?
Oh my God. Mike Tyson is a lion.
A male lion or a female lion?
That's awesome.
With a mane, a lion in his front yard, loose. It was walking, it was off the leash, man. It was not in the cage, it was in the yard.
Oh my God.
And then he came out and started wrestling with him. And
oh, my God. Damn, he wrestled. How big was the lion?
It was big, man. It was a lion.
He was wrestling with a lion.
Came over there and grabbed him and started tussling with him and all that.
Jesus.
And everybody was in the limousine. Because a lion could come up to a limousine and bust the window open and come in there. I'm sorry. He could just go like this, boof, and come right in there and just have lunch. So everybody was in the car. You couldn't back out because it was all like five limos. So everybody's in the car horrified, thinking that Mike is getting ready to be eaten by this lion, but that isn't happening.
We can't imagine what it was like to be that guy, to be able to get your own lion.
who played in The Doors, the movie, that actor
Val
who got
Kilmer?
Fat? Yeah, Val Kilmer. There's a great story, I think it's from Rolling Stone or Vanity Fair. Is it Chuck Klosterman? It might not be Chuck Klosterman, but anyway, he goes to visit Val Kilmer, and he's got lions. And the story is just hilarious. It's like he got off the plane in Tucson or wherever he was, and like from the minute he got off the plane, it was just like Alice in Wonderland weirdness.
New Mexico, right? He has a ranch in New Mexico.
I think so, yeah. Maybe New Mexico, yeah, down there somewhere.
He has lions on his ranch?
Yeah, lions running free on the ranch.
You know, he did that movie, Ghost in the Darkness, about lions. You never saw that?
No.
With Michael Douglas? Amazing, amazing movie.
Really?
It's about these lions that teamed up, male lions that teamed up in Africa when they were building railroads out there, and they started teaming up to take out the people, and they targeted people, and they killed a tremendous amount of people, And they made a fantastic movie about it. It was when Val Kilmer was sleek and beautiful and had cheekbones and six-pack, and he looked delicious. I don't know what happened to that dude. He just decided to say, fuck it.
Yeah.
But, I mean, how do you go from that beautiful? Do you imagine the kind of pussy that Val Kilmer, when he was doing the Ghost in the Darkness, got thrown at him? It's another one you can't imagine. You can't imagine what kind of a movie star he was. He was fucking Batman. I mean, wasn't he?
Yeah, I think he was.
Was Val Kilmer Batman? Yeah. I mean, he's fucking Val Kilmer. And then he became this, like, lard ass. This weird fat guy that, like, look at him now.
He's still getting all the pussy he wants, though. That's the thing.
But they're after they're done, they're like, ew, I can't believe what this fuck.
You know, he does a Mark Twain impersonation thing.
Well, I think there was like a movie or something that they were doing.
I don't think it's come out
yet.
He's doing a live performance where he like comes out with this like.
Yeah, look at that. That's him with the.
Oh wow.
With the makeup on. Yeah, there's a whole thing online somewhere where they detail the makeup process. It's incredible.
Speaking of famous people doing weird things, have you guys seen that insect sex thing that Isabella Rossellini does?
Yeah, I saw that.
Have you seen that show?
No.
It's hilarious. It's science. It's for kids. And she like wears a grasshopper outfit and like acts out the sex life of a grasshopper. It's very bizarre.
That's hilarious.
And very and
weird.
And excellent. Speaking of the lion thing, you know, there's a tiger right now in India that's killed like 9 people.
10
now. Oh, 10?
10.
The number's going up.
I've been following it very carefully. I got a Twitter feed that alerts me when people get eaten by animals.
Seriously?
No.
Where is this tiger? Why can't they catch the tiger?
Well, India is a really tricky place. There's an area in India called the Sundarbans where they've killed two, in the past 200 years, tigers have killed 300,000 people.
Wow.
It's a normal part of their diet.
It's like a swamp, right? So the tigers swim through the swamp, so you can't like hunt it down because you can't follow it.
It's also brackish. The water's brackish, and they think that might have an issue on why the tigers are so aggressive because the water is very salty, and that's all they have to drink. And so apparently it's like it makes them really irritable.
Wow.
Which is fucked.
You don't want an irritated tiger. That's
so fucked. They're in pain all the time, so they just fucking just lash out and kill people.
God, can you imagine?
But, you know, here's the thing. We were talking about this at the beginning of the conversation about the zebra and, you know, animals dying and all that.
Giraffe, yeah.
You know, there's a pretty widely respected theory that animals actually don't die in pain. Have you ever seen an antelope get run down by a lion or something?
Mm-hmm.
When it takes them down, they stop fighting.
Yeah.
You know? And the idea is that there's a huge release of endorphins at that point.
Mm.
So it's like nature's way of making it easy for you. Once you're in the grasp of the lion, the panic's over.
That makes sense. Totally makes sense. I mean, nature would engineer that because it's not like one day no antelopes are going to get killed by lions.
Right.
I mean, that is just how it goes.
Right.
Antelopes get killed by lions, and it would be probably most beneficial to everybody if the antelope didn't break the lion's jaw, kicking in and freaking out. So, you know, nature just set it up that way.
Which is pretty
cool.
We were talking about deaths. I remember reading this obituary when I was living in Manhattan. So this would be in the mid-80s, if anyone wants to look it up. I can't remember the guy's name, but he was a surgeon. And it was an obituary in the New York Times, small one. And he was a mountain climber. He loved going to Nepal and Pakistan and climbing these, like, really serious mountains. And you talked about how his friend said to him, like, dude, you know, you're a fucking surgeon, you know, you're like so highly trained. Why would you risk your life? You could die out there. And his response was always, yeah, I had this dream. And in the dream, I'm walking on a narrow ledge and the rock gives way and I scramble and try to grab onto the ledge. And then I'm falling free. And once I realize that's it, there's nothing to grab anymore. I turn and I just sail down to my death and I feel fantastic. He said, since I had that dream, I never worry about dying. You know, I'm fine with it. And that's how he died.
Wow. Holy shit.
Yeah. Yeah. It's really interesting. And so I was thinking, like, what a great death. Like the guy who climbed up the tree, that's a pretty cool death, you know? And we're all going to die. So, in a way, I mean, you've got kids, you know, you don't want to leave your kids, you know, you want to sort of like finish the story as much as you can, right? But of course, the story's never finished. And in a way, you know, again, quality versus quantity. There are cool ways to die and there are really shitty ways to die. And most of us die in the shitty way. you know, struggling, hanging on, you know, tubes up our nose and so on. There's something really cool about an organic death, about getting eaten by an animal, or in my case, stung by a scorpion. I thought I was dying, you know, that story.
Yeah.
You know, and like having that kind of death, there's something cool about that. I kind of hope I do get eaten by a shark or something.
And it also brings us back to what we were talking about in the beginning. Like, what is death? What is sleeping? You know, what is this conscious state? I mean,
do you feel death in your tank? Is that part of the tank experience?
No.
Because it's oblivion in a way, isn't it?
You definitely feel oblivion, but you're more, it's more you're alone with your own thoughts for once, away from your body. That's more what it is. And then as you become more relaxed and you learn how to let go, it becomes a pretty intense psychedelic experience.
You know how they call death in India? When Ram Dass's guru died, they say he dropped his body. Which I love that. He dropped his body. That's fucking cool, because it's like, yeah, this little finger puppet thing, we're gonna like pull the finger out for a little while. Wow. I like that a lot. I think that's a really beautiful way to look at it. Whether it's true or not,
we'll find out.
Again, we don't know if we're the same person that went to sleep yesterday. We just assume we are because we woke up and we have this memory of the past. I'm not convinced. I'm not convinced that we have a real good handle on any of it. I think the whole thing is probably way more mysterious and magical than we could ever wrap our heads around. And that's part of the reason why I think this whole sleep thing plays into the psychedelic state. I think the whole sleep thing, this 8-hour trip into the world of human neurochemicals released by the pineal gland flowing through your fucking brain while it's in REM sleep. Who knows what that's all about? Why does that even exist? You know, it's not addressed. It's one of those weird things that you don't get taught in school. You find out about later in life, and you're like, wait, what?
Yeah.
His brain makes psychedelic chemicals?
And then consider, I was listening to a Terrence McKenna lecture. At any given time, approximately half the planet is dreaming, half the planet's sleeping, half of our species is in a dream state, hallucinating at any given time. Isn't that crazy?
That's an interesting
That's
point.
Insane. Yeah. We have an 8-hour period that we don't, you know, every night we don't know what's happening.
Yeah.
We look forward to it, but we're terrified of death.
And it's a response to the fucking planet going around the sun. Like, think about that. It's like when that light is on, we're all in this place. And then when the light is off, everyone's like suddenly in the deepest hallucinatory experience that you could ever have.
Yeah.
And that's just how it is.
Yeah.
Also, one of the things I'm interested in is what has been the effect of fire on the shaping of human consciousness? Because for about 1 million years, as far as 1.2 million years, every single night our species has sat around a fire looking into those flames.
Right.
You know, how has that shaped our consciousness as a species, you know?
That's the entertainment when you're in a camp. When you're in a camp and you're all sitting around the fire, especially
and it's so cold. Fucking relaxing.
Yeah, it's great.
Oh man,
you cook over it. It warms you, and it's symbolic.
Keeps danger away.
And when that fire goes out at night, everybody goes to sleep.
Mm. Yeah,
yeah, yeah. It's very interesting.
We got to wrap this up.
Yeah,
this was awesome.
Yeah, thanks guys. This is
thanks
wonderful.
Everybody. Thank thanks you. Everybody listening to these. And these are my favorite podcasts to do. I love them.
So fun.
Yeah.
If we keep doing them, I will fly to LA from wherever the fuck I am once a month in order to do this.
Cool.
This is
beautiful. Fuck yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, let's just keep doing it. We'll do once a month from each individual podcast. And we need to name them or at least number them. So this is number 4. Is this it?
3.
3?
Isn't this 3? Yeah, because we did yours first, right?
Right.
And then Duncan's, and now this is
okay, so that was when we decided, when we did mine, that's when we decided, right? So this is the third.
This is the third shrimp parade.
Third shrimp.
So are we naming like the series or each one has a name?
Well, I think each one should have a number.
So
just so people could reference it.
Are we calling it Old People in the Snow, Three Utopians, The Shrimp Parade?
We should probably have a Twitter contest to see what people come up with. And then
how about
hashtag
the gals?
Gals will get mad at you.
Golden
man.
Gals.
Not only does this male dominated privileged asshole think that he could be sexist on his podcast with no repercussions other than the fucking creative license, and he's just trying to be funny. Fuck you, and now you're calling yourself the gals? You can't take that from us. We're the gals.
Let's call ourselves the yappy gals.
Yappy
cunts.
Yeah. That's a good one.
Three yappy cunts.
I have a friend who's writing a book called Moody Bitches.
Oh, no, he's in trouble.
She, luckily. Oh. And she's a psychiatrist. It's about women's hormonal changes.
Oh,
great
she'll
title.
She'll be okay.
Yeah, yeah.
She'll get attacked, but she'll be okay.
Right.
But my God, if it was a guy who wrote that. Thick-ankled women would fucking fall out of the sky, landing on him with axes.
Do you ever get attacked? You ever get insulted with a word that you didn't really know existed until the insult?
I always ask.
I mean, someone called me cisgendered, and I was like,
"Oh, cisgendered."
Am I cisgendered? What is that?
Yeah.
I didn't know I had
emailed
cisgenders.
It wasn't verbal.
It was an email.
What's
yeah.
cisgendered?
Means you're heterosexual male, like cisgender, identifying with the gender that you were born with. You're a freak.
You're like militantly normal or something. I also, Napoleon Chagnon tried to insult me by calling me a postmodernist. And I was like, I got to look that up before I get offended.
So what? What is that? What an idiot. Trying to define you by
what's his name?
Stupid
Napoleon
definition.
Chagnon. He's the most famous anthropologist in the world.
What a silly bitch, postmodernist.
Cool name, though, huh? Napoleon Chagnon.
Was that what he was really named? Is his real name Napoleon?
Yeah.
Postmodernist is kind of cool, too, especially if you don't think about it.
Postmodernist. Though.
Yeah.
Like postmodernism.
And what
awesome.
Comes after postmodernism? You know?
Post-postmodernism.
Yeah. You kind of like ended the series there with postmodernist.
Yeah.
It's like, how are you going to get out of that?
Yeah. An REM song. It's the end of the world as we know it.
Cool.
All right. Once a month, you fucks. We're going to keep this going.
Thanks.
Thank you, guys. It was awesome. And thank you, everybody out there.
Bye-bye.
Ciao.